And the games have started. So, welcome everybody to the show. This is the Pro Chess League playoffs. The San Jose Hackers are taking on the Dallas Destiny. Right now on your screens is our board four, Mr. Fike Alaskarov, taking on board one of Dallas and the current World Junior Champion, Jeffrey Zhang, a player who is very, very dangerous in the league. I'm International Master Kostia Kavutsky. I should say I am elect. With me are National Masters Christopher Yu and Timu Virtanen. What's up, guys?
Hello, how are you doing?
All right, guys, great intro. are you guys excited for the playoffs today?
Yeah.
Always.
Absolutely. It's going to be a very, very fun match. We are the number six seed in the playoffs. We barely snuck in. Dallas is the number three seed, and that means that we will need to win the match in order to advance. In the event of a tie, 8-8, Dallas will advance to the next round. So we have to score 8.5 points or more.
Looks like it was some, yeah. Looks like this came from a Sicilian, which moved free bishop to b5 check, and the idea is just to play I think that this position is just equal, and Fike just wants a position where he can grind out Jeffrey Zhang. Came from a Sicilian.
Whoops.
He's just going to play bishop c2 and d4 and knight bd2, knight f1.
Yeah,
looking for a position to grind it out. I don't know this opening that well.
I think this is line Fike is familiar with, but before we get into the chess, yeah. I just want to go through the lineups real quick. So Fike is on board four. On board one, we have another very strong Azeri player, probably more well-known in the chess world, Mr. Shakhriyar Mamedyarov, who's, I think, like world number three in rapid chess and world top 10 or 12 in classical chess. He's playing against Dallas's board four national master, Chris Tulin, who I believe is a pretty good rapid player. On board two, we have Grandmaster Zviad Azoria, who is a coach for Bay Area Chess. He's playing against Grandmaster Conrad Holt. And on board three for us, we have International Master Kasav Wiswanda playing against, it says I am, but we know this kid is already at least GM-elect, Ru Fangling, another very, very strong junior from Dallas. So I'll say we start with, I don't know, let's do Zviad's game, because right now this seems to be the most interesting game, this King's Indian hybrid Benoni. Timo, you play a lot of King's Indian Benoni type positions, right?
But I'm still on Jeffrey Zhang's game, and I'm not sure. I think that I'm not 100% sure about him letting a4 happen for white, because if c4, bishop c2, followed by d4 or b3, I'm not a big fan, so.
Oh, okay, yeah, we'll start with Fike's game.
I think I could probably play like g6, queen c7, bishop g7, and a5, b5 ideas.
Yeah,
I
think,
line very well. I think that I'm not a big fan of this b5.
Yeah, it's probably still following theory here for both sides, because b5 is very, very common. And a4 is the normal way too. Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
I just don't know the line well.
Mhm.
I mean, I think that Fike's doing okay here. He's just gonna play bishop b7 probably.
I imagine Jeffrey probably feels comfortable here. He spent a little bit of time. Maybe he was just trying to remember his theory. I think the main thing here for Black is that he still has to complete his development. He has to get his bishop out in castle. At some point, well, right now, White takes on b5, is going to trade rooks, and the most likely play d3 or d4 or something just to get the rest of his pieces out. Sorry?
Maybe knight a3.
Knight a3 also very possible idea, just to hit Black on the b5 square. Essentially, this started as a Sicilian, but is going to almost transpose into more of a Ruy Lopez type structure, at least as far as where all the pieces are placed.
I mean, b5's a move. There's a lot of ideas with even queen c7, bishop e7, castles, a5, get the pawn to a5 and b5, but this is just another one of those ideas. So just a very flexible opening for Black.
Absolutely. I like Fike's chances here. I think if he's in good shape, before the show, we watched Fike play some bullet to warm up. So if he's feeling well, Hopefully someone, you know, insulted him before the match as well, because we want to see Angry Fike. We want to see Angry Fike crush some some of Dallas's players. Think
it's like some people play better when they're angry, like.
Yeah, a lot of people, they play worse. They get too emotional. I think Fike plays better. He basically turns into the Hulk and starts checkmating everybody.
Some people play well when they're actually sick.
Yeah.
There's a saying, it's like a wear of the sick man or something, but okay. I mean,
beware of the sick man.
He's feeling well, so he's ready to play some interesting chess.
Yeah, and these first two rounds, since we're going to be substituting him, he's going to play Jeffrey Zhang, and then next round he's going to play Rufang Li. So I hope he scores some points against the youngsters. Let's go ahead and switch. I want to switch to actually board two, where we have Zviad playing black against Conrad Holt. And just quickly going back through the opening, he played this bishop g4 and c5, traded on e6.
It looks sort of like a Ras Limo variation,
In reverse, right? Because we have this exchange on c3, bishop takes c3, which is usually very, very controversial. On one hand, white gets a crippled queenside, which is very weak just for the rest of the game. The other hand, black has given up the dark squared bishop, which means that white's dark squared bishop is potentially a very, very powerful piece. So queen e7, bishop f4, and long castles.
This is I think that in case you short castle, I mean that bishop on g7 is a very important piece. So it's not quite as important if you long castle. So I think that's the reasoning behind it.
Yeah, I mean this is very ambitious by Zviad, and I like his decision because in the chess community, Conrad Holt is very well known to be extremely well prepared. Even considering his grandmaster level, he's considered a very, very well-prepared player. So Zviad is playing something to take him out of his comfort zone, something that he hasn't studied too deeply, and he's going to try to outplay him here. But as you can see, this is going to be very sharp position. I mean, white gets the b-file. Black is going to, I assume, try to play on the king side and try to maybe even play f6 and put his knight on e5. This is going to be an interesting game. I feel like good chances this game is going to be decisive this round.
Yeah.
Okay, just to switch to Mamedyarov's game. He's playing board 4 of Dallas, Chris Tulin. And once again, Shaq is playing, you know, at 6:30 a.m. in Baku, Azerbaijan. So he's a real champ for getting up so early and and playing for us every week.
He probably has an alarm clock to wake him up.
I would hope so, yeah. So right now I'm seeing on the board queen c7, white played f4, very committal, rook ad8, rook c1, queen e7, and now g4.
Wow.
So he's not shy, Mr. Tulin from Dallas. He's going for it. Now white has some danger on the long diagonal.
Yeah, I mean, you have more successful chances if you play very aggressively against these strong. So Mamedyarov plays h6, and because if he took with the bishop last move, knight takes d5, which is decisive. So he plays h6. And I'm wondering why not g5 for white here. I'm not sure about Mamedyarov's position.
So h6, g5 looks like the consistent follow up to what white has done. How does black respond here? He takes.
Or the knight d7 might be his idea. In case white takes the pawn, black's queen can take on g5. So he's also looking at bishop e5 to sort of stop, cut the battery off the diagonal.
Knight d7, and if knight takes d5, I probably just loses to queen takes g5 and king h1, bishop takes d5, and black is just winning everything.
But I'm just not sure if I'm a big fan of Mamedyarov's position. I mean, f5 is also something to calculate, right? Because next he wants to take on d5, which is knight.
f5, bishop goes back, let's say, to c8, and e3 pawn is also kind of tender, yeah?
Yeah, but I mean, knight takes d5, if you take queen takes g7, so I might consider a move like even queen to e5 there to try to, but I'm not sure if I'm a big fan of his position.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we have bishop takes h2 check, followed by rook takes d5, hmm?
Yeah, that's the point, exactly.
Oh, I guess that's why you put your bishop
knight takes d5, there would be, knight takes d5, there would be mate on g7.
Right.
So bishop takes h2 is the only move.
Rook d5, and I mean, we get with the dark squared bishop, but I mean, white's queen is under attack, and we're threatening to also take the e3 pawn here, so I would assume black is doing okay.
Position,
oh, for sure. Yeah, this one is sharp, and you know, once white plays g4, I mean, there's no going back from this move. White is pretty much committed to try and play this very, very aggressively. F4, G4, you know, E3 is just weakness for the rest of the game. E4 square is going to be weak. So White needs to justify it by making sure he gets enough play on the diagonal. Okay, guys, let's quickly switch to the last game. As we see, H4 was just
H4
played.
H4 just happened. He wants to play G5. I was thinking about this move a bit because he wants to play G5.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. He's ready. He's brave. He's going all in for it against a very strong player.
I think H4 is a very principled decision. Yeah. So we'll come back to this. We'll see how Shock handles this. And I want to just quickly check out how Kasov is doing against Mr. Rufeng Li. So we've got a knight orf, bishop e3, e5. And it seems like one of the quieter main lines these days with this queen d3 move, I think, has been very popular recently. Knight d5. Trade on d5.
Mm-hmm.
And we got this position on the board after black's last move, h5. Either of you guys knight orf players?
No. But the queen on a4 is such an advantage for white that black has equalized, I think. His pieces are so well coordinated by this as you know, his rooks aren't doing much, the knight on b3 is out of the game.
Mm-hmm.
So, something has gone wrong for white.
Yeah, it definitely seems like black is better here, yeah?
Black went for this g6, h5 idea, one of the more traditional positions in the knight orf, but still with sharp play.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unlike those b5 ideas and b4. Very, very sharp stuff with a lot of theory.
Right, yeah. I mean, usually in this structure, it's like, I like this move, knight d2. I mean, this is, if white has chances here, he has to get the knight to e4, I think.
But this might allow d5.
Just improving his, what?
Maybe b5 for black. Knight e4, then the bishop just goes to e7. And,
but then c5, and then followed by d, c5 followed by bishop takes c5. I mean, it's very complicated. But Kasov's just improving his worst piece, which was probably his knight on b3.
I mean, of course, strategically, this knight d2 move is the correct move. The only question is, concretely, is it going to work with the tactics of the position after b5?
Yeah. Very sharp stuff. B5.
So, I want to go back to Shock's game now, because he actually took the pawn on g4 with the knight after a minute and 23 seconds of calculation. So for Shock, this is this means he went into the tank. Because his average move time, from what I've seen in the matches, is about 4 seconds. So the fact that he spent over a minute here means he really did some heavy calculation. So bishop g4.
So what if white plays knight takes d5? I know there's something here.
Queen f8.
Oh yeah, no. Yeah. But then you could also think of playing bishop to e5 followed by rook takes d5. But then queen takes h4. But yeah.
There's no bishop
b5.
Knight
takes d7.
With check, yeah. So queen f8. So he's basically given back the pawn. He's defended g7, and now the question is, are black's bishops good here, or is white's kind of central pressure going to be the key feature here? I mean, I imagine if I was white, I'm trying to get a rook to g2 maybe as quickly as possible.
Well, it's tough for White, because if he plays knight f6, black can take it, followed that up by king h7, and black's winning. So
knight f6 not working, yeah, king h7. Knight
f6 doesn't work, it'll be tough. I think that White's king is a little loose, and it's hard to immediately exploit the pressure on the diagonal, so it's gonna be a long-term goal for White if he wants to get a result, a draw, or win this game.
Yeah, very, very sharp position. As we see, Chris Tulin is down to almost 5 minutes now. Yeah. Against Shox 11, so if he doesn't come up with something soon, he's gonna be in real trouble.
These time controls, I think a good strategy is not to get down on time, but sometimes I get down on time myself.
Well, yeah, easier said than done, because you still want to you want to play good moves.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm not really a perfectionist, but sometimes I'm so hesitant to make a move. Like, this might not be the best, because he has just annoyed me.
Right. And we've just seen e4 on the board. Very interesting.
So, okay. Chris Tulin wants to play, he just wants to push the pawns with something like, I don't know, e5 next.
Yeah, maybe e5 or f5 also makes sense.
Yeah, e5, f5, and throwing the kitchen sink at him.
Yeah, this is going to be very interesting. I'd like to see how Shaq tries to take advantage of White's, White is overextending now, but we'll see if Black has a concrete way.
That's my concern. I mean, I'm not really sure about this, but I think it's a good practical chance, because it makes Shaq sink, and I mean, putting a little bit of pressure on your opponent can make it tough, but
yeah,
Shaq seems to handle it well, so we'll take a look at this game. Let's take a look at
Well, I want to switch to Azoria's game, because things have heated up there. Queen a4, knight f6, e5 was played, which was met with bishop f5.
Black went for the poison pawn. He went for the poison pawn.
And
poison pawn.
Well, there is no pawn on b2 that was captured, but yes, the queen is somewhat exposed here. Fortunately for Black, his bishop on f5.
Yeah,
covers a crucial b1 square. And after rook d7, he's covering
h6 and g5, drive away White's pieces, so he consolidates his own position, and the bishop on f5 becomes a really good, you know, a solid piece.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So there are no h4 driving it away from the diagonal.
I mean, right now, Black might think of playing bishop c2, but the problem is then queen b5, and trading queens is probably not a good decision, because it lets White rook get to e7, so maybe queen a3 if I'll try to play a6 with ideas, so it's a lot to think about. But I mean, even if Black just moves his bishop back, it's still very sharp, so a very sharp position that could go any side's way is all I can say.
Yeah. Yeah, and to address the chat, this is Mr. Darnuk, which was Conrad Holt's, I believe that was his favorite username on the old Internet Chess Club. So I actually don't know who's watching the chat, but welcome. Let's switch quickly, as we just saw h6 and knight e4 on the board. I want to switch to Fike's game against Jeffrey, because things have cleared up a little bit here. Seems like Fike has an extra pawn on the board.
Wait, I need to take a look at that game.
It's really uncertain or unclear whether he's going to be able to use it. It's upper-scaled bishops. I mean, now he's getting the passed a pawn, which I guess is good, but his pieces aren't really coordinating for him to launch any attack, so Jeffrey definitely has the compensation.
A good thing about Fike's position is his nearly 5 minute time advantage. I mean, almost 5 minute time advantage. I mean, It's a big time advantage that, in this time control, I mean, Jeffy Zhang might feel a little uncomfortable about his time situation. I mean, Fike's obviously been playing a fine game just to get this position.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a fantastic position for us. You know, whether or not he's going to be able to use his extra pawn, I mean, draw on this board, I mean, really incredible result. Board 4 versus board 1. And not just any board 1. I mean, Jeffrey Zhang is, you know, currently 2650 FIDE. He's a world junior champion. He almost won the recent YKZ B group. I mean, and he's, you know, been incredible in the Pro Chess League so far. So Fike can hold the draw here from what looks like probably a very safe position. I think we'd be very happy here. I already like that he's made lift on h3, where black hasn't done that yet, so maybe we might see rook d1 here very quickly, and minimum white can trade queens in this position, looks like.
Just what about the
problem in this position is that bishop on a8 is more active than the c3 bishop, so white will most likely lose the a pawn, after which black will have some serious pressure against g2, whereas white bishop doesn't have any real targets at all.
Yeah, but I mean, symmetrical position, I mean, it should be fine, right? I'm expecting rook d1 here. Black take on a3.
I have an idea. It's to play this move queen d6. Sorry.
First of all,
if black plays queen takes d6, e takes d6, rook takes e3, d7, and rook to d3, and rook to c1, threatening rook to c8. And if h6, rook to c8, check, followed by d8 equals queen.
Well, that is a nice line.
My bishop to b4, and it's still probably drawable, but it's not easy. It's tough.
Yeah, queen d6. So, I mean, I also just like the simple rook d1 here, just threatening queen d8, and black has to make luft, probably h6.
I mean, if rook to d1, just bishop to d5.
Oh, bishop d5.
The bishop, and then playing queen c7, and I think that I'd rather play queen d6.
Yeah, queen d6 more active, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, activating your pieces, playing bishop b4 next. Fike's gonna...
Yeah, you're right, Christopher. I like this. So, he's calculating right now. I mean, he started this move, I think, with over 8 minutes. So, I assume he's calculating something pretty deep.
Queen d6, what will you do to queen b7?
Well, queen d8.
Mate on g2 and... Oh, wait, queen b7, there's just queen d8, mate.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's what took him so long, 3 minutes to figure out that he... Probably he's calculating the Zengame, and indeed, we see queen d6 on the board. Fantastic move. Not afraid to sacrifice the bishop because of the line Christopher found, d7 and rook c1. And black has unforgivable issues on the back rank, and white is just winning the endgame. So, of course, and queen c8 has been played on the board. Well, this gives white a chance to play bishop b4 and consolidate somewhat.
Or maybe, no, I don't know about rook c1. Rook c1 is not as stable, so maybe bishop b4, simpler.
Mm-hmm. Bishop b4 and go fight! Jeffy Jiang's a very good player, so it's gonna be hard. So bishop d2, he wants to play rook c1. We should have took a bit of a deeper look, because I think I like this move. He wants to play rook to c1. He wants to get the c-file for his rook. Just because a move looks passive, it doesn't mean that you just shouldn't consider it.
Yeah, and meanwhile, we have two results in, actually. Both Rufeng Li and Mamedyarov have won, so we've essentially traded wins here. I'm going to show Rufeng Li's win over Kesar real quick. Looks like his pieces infiltrated into white's camp. After knight e2, we did have b5. b4 was played, bishop e3. And after exchanges on c4, we have queen d1 check. And looks like black is simply picking up some material due to this pin. White has no good way of blocking the check on f1. So switching over to Mamedyarov's game real quick. He won by resignation. Looks like white here is losing the house as well. After we left off on e4, bishop e6, traded on d5, played f6 just to neutralize the pressure of the bishop on b2.
Wait, you're looking at the Zoya game, right?
No, I'm just quickly showing Shock's win, because he's already won his game in round one. So queen h5.
Convincing, because he just consolidated his position, played f6, h6, bishop f8. You would think that the white squares are really weak, but actually white has no way to exploit them. And on the other hand, he has so many weaknesses on the king side, and the d5 pawn is also not great at all.
Yeah, you're right. This was very, very nice, actually, positional play. Just secure the king, and then just this one simple move, queen f7, and the queen comes into h5, and white's overextended position ends up to be his undoing.
Yeah.
And I'll just get to the final position here. And white resigned here because queen h2, there's simply rook h3, and black wins the queen. Okay, so that means the match is tied 1-1. And we're kind of counting on Fike here to give us the critical half point to kind of turn things in our favor. I'm going to switch to Azoria's game real quick. Things have... Few things have been traded off here. It looks like white is up a pawn, but again, the structure for in white's position is not very healthy, and black here is up on time, which is quite a big lead almost 5 minutes.
Note that black can just take the pawn on f6 right now, so it looks fine for Azoria. I mean, it's still a sharp game for the amount of pieces on the board, but it's not as sharp, it's sort of okay. So Azoria is going for active pieces instead of pawns.
Yeah, after rook f6 there, maybe rook d2 was not very comfortable for black. Rook f4, queen takes d6.
Sometimes you don't win pawns to make your pieces very active.
So you gave check.
Okay, rook e2, what was Azoria's idea? Maybe queen e8, because if rook takes e5, queen takes e5, queen takes f6, with a fine queen endgame. Maybe.
Queen e8 looks pretty safe to me.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what he does, so. We'll take a brief look back at that game. Let's just take a look at Fike's. It's a little scary.
Ooh, I don't like what happened to Fike's position here. Somehow black's pieces were managed to infiltrate.
Oh, I thought I. Well, it was just a nice variation. I noticed that black had a win, so. Annoying stuff by Jeffrey. He found a way to make his pieces. So, king d1. The trap that black shouldn't fall for is bishop to b3. Rook takes b3. Rook takes b3. Queen c2. So, be careful. Watch out for those tricky tactics. So yeah, queen f2. Yeah, so yeah,
this is not good.
I mean queen to c1 might still be an idea, because bishop b3 still doesn't work for that reason, and if queen f1, rook e1, so, but then he has queen b5.
Well, what if we just combine the ideas? Queen c1, queen f1, check, rook e1, bishop b3.
Oh.
And no, this is just losing for. I mean, the opposite color bishops give such a huge advantage to the attacker that white just doesn't have a defense here.
I mean, if white's gonna have any sort of chance, he gotta play queen c3, bishop to b3, and queen takes b3, and somehow hope for that position.
Well, that's what he does. But I'm skeptical. Black will simply take on g2, take on h3. Yeah. And white just doesn't have any coordination with his pieces. So,
but still, he's going to be able to create a passed pawn.
Yeah. I think Fike just played a little bit maybe too ambitiously here, because I think there must have been a way, although it does seem tough, but there must have been a way to kind of keep the position under control. Maybe this rook e3 move was the culprit, which allows black this queen b7, queen a7. Yeah. And the game is over after queen takes g2.
Wow, what grandmaster resignation. Wow, Fike's really respecting his opponent if he just resigns here, even though he can play f4. Wow. I mean, he's okay. He's down on time, so. A questionable resign, but makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think it is kind of a hopeless position. Maybe he could have played on a little bit more, but I think maybe he just wants to recharge and get angry for the next round.
So this is a critical game, but Conrad holds 13 seconds versus Azoria that only has, who has over almost 3 minutes. So I certainly prefer Azoria here, and his endgame's perfectly fine.
Yeah, I mean, Black is not risking anything at all, and now he plays Queen E5, meaning he's quite comfortable with the King and Pawn endgame. White does not go for it. Doesn't even have time to calculate if King and Pawn endgame is good.
B4.
So only Black can win this position, and Azoria, he's pushing here, that's for sure.
He's pushing those pawns. Okay, Queen D3. It's not that simple. Maybe D5? I mean, but then, I don't know, F4? But, I mean, Queen E1? I mean, I'd certainly prefer Azoria. I mean, Conrad Holt shouldn't have... should have spent a little more time, because it's not comfortable by playing a strong GM with only 10 seconds on your clock, even if you're a GM yourself like him. So
These endgames are very tough, these queen endgames. Even if the position is drawn, you have to find such a precise series of checks sometimes just to hold a position. And with Black's pawn on c3, it's not exactly a picnic here for White.
Not exactly a picnic.
That said, White does have counterplay with a4 and a5 next, right?
Yeah, so Azoria is looking that over. So he does play d5 is his final decision.
And probably d4 here.
d4, yeah, he's looking to play. Okay, queen c7.
Queen c7.
Behind the pawn.
Very interesting.
Wow. Queen c2, his idea is b5. Queen takes a5, queen takes d5. Interesting stuff. Why not queen c5 last move?
Maybe he's worried about some queen h7 check.
Yeah, b6, yeah. Queen h7. I mean, that's just a different move order. So, wow, we're seeing some sharp stuff here. Maybe c2, because if queen d6, queen c7, queen c7 first, okay. Maybe c2, queen g8, and White just has a perpetual. b6.
B6, whoa. Gotta take.
Conrad Holt almost has no time whatsoever.
Oh, but this is not good. I mean, 3 seconds left? Yeah. Black can consolidate here with queen c6?
Yeah.
I think he's gonna flag.
Oh, he lost on
and
time.
He did flag.
But now there's no queen because queen takes f3 check.
Yeah. Ah, so he's just losing on the board. Very exactly. Queen c2, queen f3. And okay, I mean, game continues, but this is, again, not fun for White to defend. So we've tied it up. We got 2-2 after the first round. Some clutch wins by Azoria. Actually, pretty straightforward round. Both boards 1 and 2 won against the lower-rated opposition.
From our lineup, 2-2 in the first round was sort of the average score.
Yeah, I'd say it's a solid result. Nothing special for either side.
Yeah. Some exciting chess going on in a few of the games. It's a little bit of a bummer that Fike let Jeffrey Zhang get counterplay. If you're the better side, it's not good to let your opponent get counterplay. But against Jeffrey Zhang, I mean, just one little hole and it can all go wrong. So, well.
Yeah. Well, okay, next round will be starting in about 5 minutes here. I'm going to quickly check to see if there are other games going on from the other match. San Diego is currently playing against Rio Grande, so one of these teams will be knocked out tonight.
Yeah.
And we have, looks like, Grandmaster Alexei Dreyev playing against an international master from Rio Grande's team. I appreciate everyone following us currently on Twitch. I saw some shout-outs on Twitter and on Facebook, so... definitely appreciate the support and you guys watching our match. Well, tied match after one round. Round two, we're going to have, I think, 1-2. Or no, sorry, we'll have 3-1 and 4-2, I believe, from both teams. So it'll be some more potential upsets in the making.
Fuck. Spike was a potential upset, but that didn't happen.
Yeah, he was close, and currently he's a little bit frustrated in the group chat. He's saying he was very unlucky to to blow that. Meanwhile, we have other hackers getting ready to join in round 3 and 4. I don't think we've mentioned it on the show just yet, but in rounds 3, we'll be making 3 substitutions. So Shock is staying in, of course, our leader, our furious board 1. And on boards 2, 3, and 4, we're going to have Grandmasters Daniel Naroditsky, Grandmaster Christian Carrilla, and National Master Ivan Key coming in for the hackers to win this match. Now, it'll be very, very exciting to see, I think, the final rounds of today, because I believe it's going to be very, very close one way or the other.
Yeah. So, somebody in this Spike game got 9 out of 18 guesses, somebody got 6 out of 10, and some FM got 9 out of 18, somebody got 6 out of 10, and somebody got 3 out of 17. So... Yeah,
I really like this new Guess the Move feature introduced by chess.com.
Yeah, I've tried that a few times, but they haven't done very well. Sometimes I play the right move, but the players don't always play the right move. So sometimes it can be hard to guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good feature for the fans. They follow their favorite player's game. They try to guess the moves, especially in Blitz and Bullet. And if they do get a few right, it feels good. It's like, oh wow, I'm playing, you know, as good as a grandmaster in this sharp position.
So it seems like all the playoff matches have been really close. Michael's saying that all those have been 9-7 or even closer today. That's some fighting spirit.
Yeah, some huge...
No teams going down without a fight.
Some huge matches. Real quick, I want to do a shout out to the Charlotte Chess Center. Apparently, they have us on there on the big screen. So those are my boys, my friends in Charlotte. Thank you guys for supporting the team and for tuning in. We're very happy to have you watching. And the next round will be starting, looks like, in just a couple minutes.
Yeah, let's take a look at this game that Dreve is playing against. I am Joshua Ruiz Castillo, who I actually lost to. But I'm not 100% sure about Dreve's position. I mean, White's just going to play Castle and Rookie 1, F4 in this... some sort of Sicilian modern defense. I mean, I'm not sure. I don't really like his position so much.
Well, I guess you'll have to prove you wrong, Christopher.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of these strong players have proved me wrong, so I'm ready to see some surprising results. I mean, it's only move 22, and both of them are getting close to 5 minutes, and Joshua Ruiz is under 5 minutes, so
mm-hmm.
they're being very careful in these time controls.
So I haven't seen all the matches earlier today. I do know that Norway did beat, I believe, Mumbai by a very, very tight score, so they're advancing to the next round. And the London Towers defeated Amsterdam, which was, I think, a bit of an upset. I believe that Amsterdam was at a higher seed. And then I think Montclair defeated Philadelphia, which is kind of a big result for the Atlantic Division because Philadelphia was doing very, very well earlier in the season. And Miami, I believe, narrowly squeezed out a win over Toronto, which was another, I wouldn't say an upset, but I think a lot of people were liking Toronto's chances. They've been very consistent in the league so far.
So some exciting chess in the playoffs and some surprising results. This is what the fans want to see. It's March Madness and basketball's going on. There's a lot of stuff going on in March. The chess playoffs and the NCAA basketball March Madness, so it's not just chess, it's basketball. much is going to be an exciting one, especially all this commentating on the playoffs. The games seem like they're going to start soon because it's 7:10.
Yeah, any moment now. And it looks like Jeffrey Zhang's game has already started against our newest player on the Hackers, International Master Kaysov Wiswanda, who's playing this hybrid, hello, I'd say, Nimzo Indian against the English setup.
B3, Bishop B2, a sideline, but no problems with it. They're blitzing on moves. I wonder if this was prep or anything. Some sideline from Jeffrey Zhang, playing normal stuff, but then going for this B3, Bishop B2 idea. I mean, interesting.
Yeah, clearly an opening very familiar to both players. We just saw Mamadiaru's game was aborted. This was a glitch, actually. They emailed us about. Apparently, a lot of games in the playoffs are being aborted today, just randomly, some kind of glitch in the server. So both players need to refresh their page, I think, and start the new game. I'm sure they'll get it sorted out pretty soon.
My game is also going. I'm trying to find some other games. Azoria's game. Wait, I'm trying to find Mamadiaru's game. I don't see Mamadiaru's game.
That game hasn't started yet. I think they're sorting out some technical issues. But I'm sure they'll start it and they won't forfeit shock.
On my screen it says Mamadiaru declined to draw.
No, I think that's just some glitch. I wouldn't worry about that.
Okay.
Yeah, as we see the game still getting aborted, so we'll let the league figure that out. For now, let's go on to a game that's currently in progress. I'm looking at Rufeng Li's game against our boy Fike, and he's angrily played g6, bishop g7, indicating that he wants some kind of hybrid, non-theoretical position against Rufeng Li of Dallas. So hey. f4. Takes d5, striking back in the center, queen d2, and d takes e4.
My intuition is just telling me that this cannot be good for black. It somehow feels like he doesn't have logical squares for his pieces.
Yeah, a lot of dark squares seem kind of weak.
The b2 pawn is hanging. I mean, at least just queenside castle, like what he did. I mean, I would prefer white here. He really has no weaknesses. Black's dark squares are weak. White was thinking of playing h4 and h5. But it's still not that easy. It's some interesting sideline stuff from Fike. So he goes knight f5, which is what I would play, or I was expecting, and if h4, maybe he's thinking about even h5, so knight f3, knight f3 comes.
What is black going to do about his queen side? You know, bishop e6, knight d7, they're moves, but they seem kind of pointless.
Yeah, that was another thing that's concerning. It just seems as white's attack is just much faster than black, or white can do stuff on the king side that annoys black, that makes his pieces go on passive squares. So I would prefer white, but it's not that bad.
I'm going to make a bold prediction here. I'm going to say that Fike is going to play queen b6 and then queen takes b2, checkmate. I think there's a good chance of this happening. Oh, knight a6. So he doesn't go for it. Interesting. I had maiden two.
Okay, I like knight a6. It's slightly better than knight d7. At least it has some options with knight b4 in the future. Like after queen b6, knight b4.
Yeah.
Very sharp. Bishop e5. Solid move by white. Trading off. Yeah. Kind of neutralizing black's very, very powerful dark squared bishop.
Especially in the... It would be even more important to keep this position, this bishop, if it was a dragon. But even here, it's sort of like a dragon. It's a very important piece that white wants to trade off, because without this piece, it just his dark squares are falling apart. I mean, even if white would just let's say, lose his, let's say, c2 pawn, and after these bishops are traded, it's not simple because of black's dark squares. So, yeah.
Yeah, very, very sharp. Looks like Mama Diara's game has started. I'm going to switch to that real quick. And we have a Slav with knight c3, d takes c4, e3, and this early b5. That's kind of a sharp theoretical line in the Slav. I'm sure both players here are fairly familiar with what they're doing. Knight f3 on the board. So eventually, white is just going to try and round up this c4 pawn. Trying to put the knight on d2, maybe queen c2, and just take the pawn on c4 and try to make advantage of his solid central control.
Yeah. We appreciate all of Mama Dayev's efforts of bringing us exciting chess at 6:30 a.m. in the morning. He's very pumped up. I mean, these guys tend to play more energetic in the morning because they're not tired at all. They're ready to kill each other out.
No, you know, Christopher, once you get older, you'll realize that the morning is actually the hardest time to play chess because you're still not fully waking up.
Well, I actually sort of like the middle of the day better than the morning, but I mean, yeah. I mean, it's the morning, and let's hope that he woke up at, I don't know, who cares. So it was a very short line of the Slav defense, and white's looking for a compensation, but black, okay, so he just played this move b3, looking to play queen c2 and knight d2, but I mean, if queen c2, c takes b3, so I think that he's looking for knight d2 right away. So he just, now he's playing queen a5 to defend the bishop, and now Mamadeyev takes and then move c5 to try to support this pawn on b4 and try to strike at white center's prey. So I think that I'm expecting a move like bishop to b2, followed by a move maybe like e4 and then d5 to open up the bishop. So
there you go, you're playing like Mama Darv. If you're in the chess.com board, Christopher, you would have gotten a guess the move point by playing bishop b2, because that was just made on the board. And rook d8, oh, interesting move by Conrad, just lining up the rook against the queen. Yeah. Just in general, a good strategy.
Like queen b6, queen b3, I'm sorry, queen b3, and then moving one of the rooks to c1 and d1 and just playing normal chess because...
Are you ever going to move one of your pawns in the center? Because, you know, there will be move the d pawn, there might be knight c5 coming, or just, you know, if you don't allow black to take first, then there will be a promised e2. So, Shark played queen c2, I think, also makes sense.
Yeah.
Now he's
same idea, he just wants d5. To make. I mean, the knight on g3 protects the e2 bishop, so. But I think maybe the queen on c2 is more preferable than the queen on b3, but I'm pretty sure that Shark just wants to play a sharp game with rook fd1 and even consider d5, e4 ideas even, and play sharp chess, so.
So I'm going to switch over to Zviad's game here. He's played a kind of a Catalan setup against board 4 for Dallas, Chris Tulin. And as we see in the live position, he's gotten his pawn to c6. I'm going to quickly jump there by going through the moves. We have a lot of a typical exchange here. This knight takes f4, where black gets the two bishops, but white gets this kind of better control in the center. And d5, that's not a move you usually see, taking advantage of the pressure on the c-file. So if c takes d5, we have knight takes d5, and queen takes c2 loses to knight takes e7 in between move, and then rook takes c2.
So it's going... isolated pawn positions where occasionally d5, I mean, I meant with the pawns on c6 and e6, not isolated pawn positions, d5 is a good move, but that's not usually the case. So this is almost sort of like those kinds of situations where I think that it was smart to play d5 for concrete reasons. I looked at a few of those games where that happens, and some of them are interesting.
So now we've got this position on the board, and I'd expect some move by the knight here. Maybe either, oh, never mind, as I'm saying, that queen a4 is played. And just hitting the bishop and...
Wait, is the bishop trapped?
I mean, I don't know.
What does it have? There's no way to protect the bishop. It doesn't have any squares either.
Guys, this isn't fair. I was expecting some positional move like knight e5, just securing the c6 pawn, and Zviad's like, oh,
yeah,
bishop's hanging.
Like knight e5 followed by knight d7, but free piece, yeah. That's way better.
Wow, yeah. So I'm going to expect... I mean, can black get anything here for the piece? I mean, anything.
Not even a pawn. Like, I mean, c6, probably, yes, but that doesn't count as a pawn. It's just versing your own pieces. a7 will be hanging too.
Yeah, well, okay. I mean, white is just winning here. So we'll switch over to... Let's go to a game we haven't seen yet too much, actually. Jeffrey's game against Kasov. Looks like Jeffrey has gotten the typical two bishops advantage that we see in all kinds of Nimzo Indian, Bogo Indian, Nimzo Bogo, Catalan, Queens Indian type openings. And Kasov has gotten his bishop out over to h5, which is kind of unusual. Usually this bishop sits where the queen currently is on b7. And black has, well, a very nice structure, small space advantage. And Jeffrey's playing, basically he's playing a hedgehog here, with the c4 pawn not yet been traded off for one of black's d-pawn.
There's this interesting idea with g4 followed by e4 to restrict this g6 bishop, and then play king g3, and I mean not king g3, and rook g1, and then play g5, and then open up the g-file. But right now, Jeffrey Zhang's moving his king out of the diagonal, but he might think of g4 and e4 to restrict the bishop and control the d5 square too. So,
well, that was interesting.
Just something to consider.
He just played king h2, black played queen c7, kind of lining the queen up against the king, and then he backs up king g1. So Jeffrey Zhang is currently pulling a Magnus where he's basically not doing anything, wants to see how black is going to react, and he's going to kind of delay the fight to a later point in the game here.
So queen d7, I mean...
They're just basically repeating the position. I think Kasov is just giving Jeffrey the satisfaction of doing something productive, because, you know, draw would be a good result, so Kasov understands that and does nothing, so he forces Jeffrey Zion to take action here.
Absolutely, he stays up on the clock, and he's like, I'm not going to do anything here.
That's really a good strategy. I mean, I think that he should be playing a little more sharp if he wants to at least get a draw, but it's an interesting strategy, but if he's ever going to do such a strategy, at least he needs some sort of time advantage. He has a little one, but
black always has a d5 followed by d4 trying to close down the position with a huge space advantage.
I don't think that Kasov is necessarily playing for a draw just because it's a little positional. Maybe that's his strength and he wants to play d5 next and he's not just going to draw this game.
So. Yeah, I wouldn't say he's playing for a draw. I would just say that he's not looking to take any unnecessary risk in the position because he doesn't need to. And honestly, I mean, if I had to choose, I would rather take black here. I mean, I always like having the space advantage, and it's not clear how white is going to open the position. I mean, d4, b4, none of these look particularly satisfying right now. So
g4 and e4, if Jeffrey Zhang wants to take some action, he got to do that.
But, you know, then you give up the d4 square, and it's...
I mean, yeah, that might be the issue, but your bishop has some good control over it, and I don't think knight d4 right away really works, so he's just going to think of king h2, rook g1, and bring the rooks in, play h4, use the g4 pawn. I mean, the bishop's restricted, he's thinking about knight h4, so if he wants to take some action, I would play g4. But if h5, g5, and then king h2, knight h4, so if he wants to make the position a little more sharp, he should probably do that. Let's take a look at Okay, Azorius just completely winning.
Yeah, I'm gonna go back to Shock's game here because we've had some changes in the structure. After queen c2, queen c7, rook d1, trade on d4, bishop e7, and d5. This very thematic break.
So I was telling you that he might do this at some point, open up his bishop and...
So if takes on d5, then we're playing knight f5 with white, right? And it looks like white just gets a huge initiative here. So bishop c5 was played, d e6, and knight e4. You know, Shock a few years ago, not in this opening, but similar structure, won a game against Anish Giri in exactly 20 moves. So I think he feels very, very comfortable in these kinds of positions here with white.
Wow, I can't, wow, that's surprising.
So he has one to go.
What's that?
One move to go.
Yeah, one move to go, and then Conrad Hall will have survived longer than Anish Giri.
Anish Giri is a very hard player to beat.
I know. It was quite some game, but I really like white's position here. I mean, some knight is coming to g5. It's looking good.
Yeah. I mean, we should be let's just briefly take a look at Chris Tool's game versus Azoria. So he just plays knight a5. He's just pulling off the finishing punches.
This game is basically over. I mean, he might be trying to calculate some bishop takes e3, but it's just so unlikely that any of this stuff will ever work. I mean, white is already up a piece.
I mean, bishop takes e3.
The rook's just hanging. There's nothing left, really.
So knight e4.
Knight takes e5, a practical choice. No, doesn't have to worry about taking on e3 or f2. Consolidating his position.
Yeah, so I mean, we don't have to spend time here. I actually want to switch to Ru Feng's game because this is really heating up against Fike.
He just played this move b4, and his idea is if the knight moves knight e4, and that seems to win the exchange and possibly the c6 pawn. So I wonder, was there any original way that Fike was planning to deal with this move or not?
I think it's probably a move he overlooked, and it's unfortunate that this knight takes f6 comes with check. Otherwise, we can consider removing the knight and then in response to knight e4, play queen d5 and threaten the a2 pawn. But knight takes f6 is a check, and that is not going to work out for black. So Fike is going to have to come up with something here. I don't know. I don't really see anything at first glance.
Maybe. I have this absolutely crazy idea.
Uh-huh, let's hear it.
Knight to b3?
Absolutely.
I'm not sure. It's just a crazy idea to try to open some lines, but I don't think it works, yeah.
Well, how does white refute this, actually? Do which pawn do they take with, or do they just move their queen?
Yeah, I mean... They just play c takes b3 and knight to e4 and take one, king a1, nothing. I think he just overlooked.
Queen d4, there's queen b2, and white is holding on quite comfortably, huh?
So this is a concerning condition for Fike.
Well, he's either going to lose quickly or he's going to win game of the week, as we just saw. Knight b3 is on the board.
He just did what I just said. I wonder if you heard my commentary.
You guessed the move. Did you input it in? You get the point for guess the move.
No, I know. I'm not playing guess the move here. Not during my commentary, no.
Alright, so Zviad has finally finished it off. So he has 2-0 for the day. Excellent job. Exactly what we hoped he would do. And that is the first official result of round 2. Black simply resigned after b4. He's just down a piece. No compensation. White is trading rook soon. And there's just no reason to play on here. Looks like Fike is definitely in trouble because of the line. Christopher, you just said the c takes b3. Looks fairly convincing in simply knight e4. Maybe he has some other ideas, but it's hard to believe. So let's switch back to
Mufang by playing extremely sharp stuff. So
we, we'll switch back to Shaq's game. After knight e4, bishop b7, he took on c5. Queen takes c5. Now white has the two bishops, and is going to especially try to use this dark-squared bishop in the position, because...
I think that he's just going to... An idea is to play bishop to d4, followed by queen b2, to bring that battery on, and play rook to b1, and then take the b4 pawn. So let me guess queen b2.
Yeah, oh, and c5.
Oh, it's c5. Oh, my guess was incorrect.
Oh, no. Oh.
Yeah, c5 makes sense. I mean, I probably should have guessed that. He wants to get the c pawn rolling. That's another good thing about Mamadeo's position. I just like Mamadeo's.
Yeah, bishop is coming to c4, knight g5.
His bishops, bishop b5, bishop takes f6 is in the air, his pawn on e6, and in calculation, I don't see anything, so...
Yeah, I mean, I like Mamadiev, how he plays. I like him as a person. Just overall, great guy all around. Yeah. We'll switch quickly to Jeffrey's game. Looks like we have a trade. Jeffrey finally did play g4 and knight h4, so he wants to take the bishop on g6, queen e7, and knight g6, hd, bishop g2. So now we have an absolute classic. Two bishops versus two knights position. No pawns have been traded yet, but... pawn structure is very flexible for both sides. In fact, we might see an f4 in white's future just to open up the center, open up the long diagonal.
Move 26 and no pawns traded. I remember that I went to like move 35 and not a single pawn had been traded against the same guy, Kesov. I played Kesov and the same thing happened. For 35 moves, no pawns were traded. Wow, so we have another one of those. The people, they're willing to keep the pieces and play an interesting game for us.
Yeah, and as we see, Kesov's clock is running down. He's down to just about half of what his opponent has. And yeah. I would expect f4 here very soon coming from Jeffrey. And
yeah.
Well, we'll see. I think Kesov will have to fight his way out of this one, but it is a tough position. Both of White's bishops are now... absolutely, you know, powerful pieces. I like queen h4. Black does have to go active here, and we'll see how this game continues.
Just in a moment, let's take a look at Fike's absolutely crazy ideas.
So Rufeng took on b3 with the a pawn, a takes b3, and just took again. Queen e5 was played, d4. Well, if this is working for white, then he's good. But, I mean, it looks a little bit shaky. I don't know. There's bishop f5 check. And
I mean, bishop f5, king to b2, and rook a1. Seems yeah. to take things under control.
Yeah.
So, I think that I'd probably call this 1-0. You never know what might happen in the pro chess league, but it's a mouse whipper. Bad blunders, a swindle because of the fast time controls. So we're going to take a little bit a look. We'll take a brief look at this one. But let's take a look at the Mamadiev game, what he's made out of his position.
Okay, so backing up a few moves. Bishop b4, bishop d5.
Yeah.
Rook c1. So Mamadiev is banking on his c-pawn here to basically lead the charge with c6 coming next.
I'm guessing rook to b8 right now. Let's see if I guessed right. I mean, just attacking the queen and then maybe playing bishop to c6 next and castling. But the thing is that it's hard to suggest a move for black because all of white's pieces are just doing well compared to black's pieces.
Yeah, I'm seeing the conversation in the chat. Yeah, Timo, there was this like bracket challenge. Okay. It's probably over now since the matches have already started, but you could have basically like March Madness, you could choose teams that you think are going to advance, and you know, they award prizes to whoever gets the closest bracket to what actually happens. I filled one out, of course, on my bracket. San Jose is going to the finals and defeating the Marcel Migraines, as we see What is going on here?
It's tactics. It's tactics. Bishop takes b5, bishop takes d8, and if he takes, bishop takes b5, followed by rook takes d7. And Mamedov's winning, so some tricky tactics by Mamedov.
Gee, what a queen sack. Oh my god. So he takes on b5, we take on d8, and whichever way takes back takes on b5, and then this knight is hanging. White's going to end up with a rook and two minor pieces for the queen. He didn't get enough last week against Wesley So. He wants to defeat the queen again with minor pieces. Man, and Conrad recaptures g takes f6. He doesn't want to go into that at all. What a move. What a move.
I really like Mamedov's position, so let's take a look at this Kasparov game again.
Well, yeah, just to finish up here, Chris, I mean, now...
What happened? Yeah, I mean, queen g4, king, okay, knight d4, he just wants to bring his knight in. Mamedov's just bringing all his pieces to the attack, c6. Let me see,
knight d5, everything's just crashing through.
Yeah, unfortunately, Conrad Holt has denied Mamedov the move slash game of the week by not accepting the sacrifice. Poor sportsmanship, in my opinion, by Conrad. it does look good, very, very good for White here. Now, I want to go back to Fike's game because I don't think this is that clear of a position anymore because... Or maybe I could be wrong. So d4, queen c7, knight e6, queen a7, king c2. You know, I actually miscounted. For some reason, I thought White had two pieces for the rook. But what I didn't realize is that actually these are two extra pieces. So maybe this isn't all that great for Black.
Oh, yeah.
No, he just has to play. Oh.
Look Whoa.
Oh.
Spoke too soon.
Mike.
Wow.
Wow.
But I'm still not sure this is enough. Because rook a1, I'm not sure this is enough.
Yeah.
Oh! Queen a2? What was that?
Now it's two pieces for the...
This is
game of the week coming. Rook f takes d2, how does... Oh, wait, no, there's bishop e4. For a moment, I thought this...
Rook to e2, rook to e2. Okay, he takes with the other rook. Interesting.
Wow, Fike doing his best to fight back. Man, such tactics. They went by so fast. I'm just going to rewind a little bit. So rook f2, pinning the queen and king. Simple decoy tactic, trying to get to queen a2. Rook a1, the only defense. And then queen a2.
Wow.
This is unbelievable. But now I still think, Roy Feng Li is most likely winning. He has too many pawns on the queen side. These pieces are coordinating really well.
I mean, this is just not fair, you know, from an aesthetic point of view. I mean, Black just came up with, from a lost position, you know, these these insane tactics. But, okay, I mean, White still has to kind of get out of this, right? Two rooks are very active.
Yeah.
H5, now there might just be H4 followed by rook G1. And G6 will be gone soon. Even if Black gets the best H pawn, it won't compensate for the fact that White's pieces are so active. C6 will most likely fall, and just not looking good.
I mean, rook to f6 followed by rook to h3 might be my idea. So, but okay, knight d7. He's just getting his knight to e5, and he's ready to capture the g6 pawn. I'm not a big fan.
Yeah, this is most likely winning for White. But man, what an effort, though, put up by Fike, especially with such low time. I mean, I'm just stunned by those tactics. Those were very, very cool. Let me quickly check up on the other games. Looks like Kasov is way down on time in a position that's still quite difficult for him. Jeffrey Zhang got 3 minutes to torture Kasov here with the two bishops just lined up against... against Black's king here. I mean, objectively, the position might not be terrible, but with such little time, this is a difficult defense.
I mean, why can't Jeffrey just take the f7 pawn here, and he's just better while winning.
Probably he could, but then he'd have to give up one of his prized bishops, you know, that's not easy.
I mean, let me just guess that move. But
but not just knight f6 followed by king g8. It's not all that clear because g4 will be hanging.
That's right, true. I mean, white is under a little bit of pressure here.
Or maybe even king g6 and followed by rook, doubling rooks on the h-file.
That's what I was thinking. You know, when in doubt, always play king g6 in this kind of position because you never know when you're going to need your second rook. You got to keep the rooks connected, you know?
True. Yeah.
Okay, wow. Rufeng has, well, won all of black's pawns, basically, and now this is just going to be a hopeless endgame.
Let's keep our eyes on this game.
Yeah, you never know.
Mike surprised us last time. This is a similar position.
I mean, honestly, though, White could blunder his rook here, and he would still be better in the position, you know? Just so many pawns.
Yeah. Now, I think rook h7 is just directly checkmate. Pretty sure there's no way stopping a checkmate. Rook h7.
Oh, okay, bishop a4 is good enough. Yeah, that's going to be resigns. Mamedyarov. Let's see what's going on here. So knight d6 was played. Rook takes c7. And knight f5. So some tactics on the board here. Very sharp position, actually. Very sharp. e f5, rook takes c7, and rook takes d5. So they've simplified this position, but, I mean, unless black has something immediate, white has a big advantage because black's kingside here is just so weak.
Yeah.
So this round is looking to be another tie, another 2-2, barring any catastrophes.
Wow. It's a exciting match. I have an exciting variation for us to tell you. Rook takes e5, f takes e5, bishop to c4, rook f7, queen b8, king to g7, queen takes bishop takes. Okay. Maybe it's actually not that exciting. and then bishop takes f7 followed by winning a pawn, but winning a pawn in that queen endgame, it's not that clear. So Mamedyarov goes on the traditional rather.
I don't know, probably winning. It's just that he can't really calculate as fast as you do, Chris. So he didn't want to take any risk. Now, I mean, some wild things were going on in Kaysov's game against Jeffrey Zhang. I'm gonna back up a few moves there.
Let's take a look.
We did get the g4 pawn, but white went into this endgame where a lot of black's pawns are falling.
Let's just keep our eyes on this game. We've seen a lot of surprises in the pro chess league, so you never know what might happen to this game. We'll keep our eyes on this game for a little bit.
Yeah, it just seems like the bishop is too strong in this position, and all of black's pawns are weak. Man, Jeffrey Zhang, Rufeng Li, they've worked on capturing all of the opponent's pawns.
Now it's just a thing. Yeah. Rook g5, white is up 4 or 3 pawns in the end.
Yeah, maybe, king f3 now.
Yeah, 3 pawns extra. This is over.
Yeah, so, and Mamedyarov has won his game, actually. That was surprisingly quick. What happened here? So he played knight g4, tactical blunder, queen c4 check. Black is forced to trade queens. And we take on g4 and winning a piece. So nice win by Shock there. And this is going to be the final game, this rook end game, where we assume Jeffrey Zhang will convert, and rook a5 here should be resigns. Nope. Goes for the check.
Wait. Oh, yeah. You mean Jeffrey Zhang's game. Let's find that. Oh, yeah. Jeffrey Zhang yep. Now it's resignation from Kasov. So a win there. And it looks like it's going to also be a win in, Oh, wait, all the games are finished, right?
Yeah, we're all tied up. Another 2-2 round.
That was very uneventful in the results section, but crazy game, nonetheless.
Yeah, I mean, we're following the trend in the league. You know, every match has been very, very tight. And I think this is okay for us, but I do want to remind the viewers that in the event of an 8-8 tie, it is Dallas that advances to the next round by virtue of their higher playoff seeding. So technically, they have draw odds. However, I feel like we're going to have an advantage in the last two rounds as some of the higher seeds start facing each other. And I like Shock's chances to basically sweep the field and earn us a lot of points.
Oh, then yeah. The nerves are on us. I'm getting a little nervous. This is nerve-wracking. Exciting playoff chess. The fans want to see some close matches be played out. We won 8.5, 7.5. We still advance. Anyway.
I think what this will come down to is if Narodiski is going to perform today. You know, I think he's a critical player. Whether he's able to win against Jefferson and Rufeng Li, those are his games, and those will decide the match, I call it now.
Yeah, Dania is coming in. He's going to be playing board 2, and he is basically the same rating as Jeffrey Zhang and higher rated than Rufeng. And he hasn't done well in the last few weeks. I think he's done okay, but he hasn't done as well as he would have liked to have done. Let's put it that way. Especially against the match in Las Vegas, he was struggling. So if he can show up today and perform to his usual speed. I think we have great chances of taking this match. On board 3, we're going to have Grandmaster Christian Kirilla coming in. He's one of the lead coaches for Bay Area Chess. And he's done, I think, really excellent for us in the league. He's typically playing on board 3 and scoring a lot of points in every match. And on board 4, we're going to have Mr. Ivan Key, who is lower rated than all the Dallas guys. But Ivan has scored a number of upsets in the league so far. So if Ivan can put up some points and our top guys perform well, I mean, it looks good. It looks good. I think 4-4 going into halftime is a pretty decent score for us.
It'll be fun. Apparently, I'm not playing anymore for... Wait, am I going to be playing in any of the playoff matches, or am I just going to commentate?
Well, we'll see, Christopher. We don't want to give away anything to our future opponents, but who knows? We might throw you in there. You know, maybe when we take on Norway.
That'll be exciting and nerve-wracking at the same time, if that happens. So we're just waiting for the next game, which starts in about 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
We'll briefly take a look at some of the other games that are going on, like Keith and Kira's game versus Joshua Ruiz.
Right now, I'm actually opened up to the game between Andres Dukopin, Grandmaster for Rio Grande, against I am Michael Brown, who plays for San Diego. Very, very sharp position here.
Michael Brown is an I am, or I could say I am a Lek. So right now, Michael Brown just took this e4 pawn. An interesting position that I think is about... I actually sort of prefer black. He's just gonna, the bishop d3, he can just play, let's say, queen to e6. And he has this strong knight on d5 that's looking to go to f4. I mean, not too many issues here for black. I mean, he's done a good job equalizing. The only slight concern is only 4 minutes 11 seconds on this clock, but it's not a big concern, but it's only on move 22, so he's certainly playing very carefully in this game, I mean.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, it seems like black has a nice grip on the light squares here. It's funny, when I opened up this position, I thought like, ooh, e4, that looks strong, knight has to go back. I didn't realize that the pawn is just hanging. So I don't know, I think Michael's doing quite okay here. I mean, Andre is thinking, so he just plays queen d2, maybe brings the rook in next. He's going to look for compensation here, that's for sure.
No, it's equal in material.
Oh, is it? Oh, it is. Oh, so black won a pawn back that he was down. Never mind. Well, it feels like white is down a pawn.
They more like exchange the pawn on e4, because the initial there was a black pawn on e4. The white game to exchange with f3, but my comment on this position is that white is actually better here, I would say. Because
he's
going to go with rook e1, maybe a bishop g3 or a knight g3. Black's pieces, they look nice, but they're doing nothing. So I would just take white without any doubt.
Wow. Well, interesting to say that, but there's this interesting move, h5 here, to try to strike at the g4 pawn. Also interesting is this move, that one is an exchange. So h5 is the interesting move to strike. g5.
Oh, g5. Wow.
g5 and h5. This is his idea. He found a better version of what I was talking about. He wants to play h5, strike at the d4 pawn.
Okay, the next round is starting up. So I'm switching to Mamedyarov's game against Rufeng Li.
Yep. Wait, I'm just getting all the games.
And I need to follow our other two players. Timo, yep, do you remember Daniel's username? Is it just his name?
Yeah, Daniel Naroditsky.
Ah, perfect. Thank you. And we're going to follow Ivan as well.
Yeah. I got all the games. I'm following them. So we are going to have an exciting third round in the office.
Yeah, we see we have the F3 Nimzo. This is the same opening that Shock used to defeat world number 2 Wesley So last week. We all witnessed that game, which was very nearly the game of the week, because that was a really fantastic game. Here, I think Rufeng is playing very similar line. We'll see how that game deviates. I'm sure Rufeng doesn't want the same fate as befell Mr. Wesley So.
G4 again. Pushing Geronimo up the board. H4. Yeah. Knight e2 and then G4. Boom. I mean, going crazy like the Wesley So game. We all want game of the week.
Yeah.
We want some sharp chess. So B5. I think that he got his attacking style from Wesley So.
Well, clearly Rufeng has used the Wesley So game to prepare for this game, throwing out B5 relatively quickly. And yeah. I don't remember exactly how that game continued or if it was this exact position, but very, very similar. At some point, maybe knight f4, take on d5, and knight takes d5.
Again, he looks very serious to beat Mamedyarov, as Wesley was totally ready and to play aggressive. He also seems very serious against his game against Mamedyarov. All these photos exactly show how they're feeling when they play Mamedyarov. Very serious, ready to show what they've got. Like Wesley's cat was very serious too. So these two seem alike, and they're both going for the attack and playing aggressively. So Mamedyarov has something to think about. I don't think G4 is actually a very smart idea here. I mean, it's not the dragon, so he just plays knight to G3. Yeah.
He definitely needs to plays knight to G3 first.
Yeah, bishop to D2 and then A3, so doesn't look quite as sharp as the photos that we saw from the black side. But okay, it's an interesting position that's very sidelined. So we'll take a look at this interesting game.
Yeah, let's see. We have Daniel Naroditsky joining in. He's playing against Jeffrey Zhang. He's playing the London system, which he's been trotting out in a lot of his pro chess league games. Bishop g3, bishop b5, queen b6, and now he's taking a think whether he wants to exchange on c6 right away or play a move like a4 or something.
I'm not sure what he should do here. I mean, taking on c6 just leaves a very double-edged position where Black could think of putting his bishop on a6 and even think of playing bishop to d3 and rerouting it to this g6 square, which it keeps control of the h7 pawn in case anything happens. So there's some interesting ideas in here. Daniel decides not to give up his bishop for those sort of reasons, and he plays a4, h6. So, just normal Indian game stuff. A rather traditional position, but if Daniel plays rook h4 and g4, we are ready for some tactics.
Absolutely. I would love to see that from Daniel. Okay, let's see. We have Christian playing on board 3 against Chris Tulin, who is currently 0-2, but okay, he's been putting up a fight in his games. He blundered a piece last round to Zviad, but before that, he was really taking it to shock. And now he's played this queen a4 check sideline against Christian's Grunfeld that actually a lot of players have been playing so far in this league against Christian. Most likely this is some preparation by Mr. Tulin here. And e4 and bishop c6 is on the board.
Yeah, but we've seen Christian do very well against these kinds of anti-Grunfeld systems. You know, he really knows what to... he's really well prepared against the Grunfeld and even the sidelines.
Yeah, so, I mean, looks like E5.
The opponents haven't proved any advantage. The E5 doesn't seem critical at all. You know, knight D5, I just don't see anything for white. Keeping the pawn back on D2 just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and he spent almost 2 minutes on this move, which means that he's definitely out of his book here. So E5 is not, you know, let's say a stockfish move. It's a move that he came up with himself. And no offense to Mr. Tulin, but he is not going to play as well as stockfish. Maybe, so maybe it's good he's out of his book.
Maybe he was using chess base and he was all hooked up. He was so proud of himself that he put the novelty button. You looks like, but he's spending some time. So not 100% sure if this was prep or just something that he wanted to try out against Krilla, but it was probably prep. I'm pretty sure he's just gonna play d4 here, knight b6, e6 castles. I mean, the problem is with d4 might be knight b6 followed by bishop takes f3.
Right. And so okay. He throws that e6.
This might interesting. So the pawn sacrifice. Wow, I think that he got this from the movie Pawn Sacrifice. He's doing this interesting pawn sacrifice that seems to ruin Black's pawn structure, and he might think of knight e4 and knight g5, h4, h5, and jumping in with the knight on g5.
Yeah,
to me, this
is all in.
Doesn't seem sound actually. Black has so much more well-developed. Yeah. Black just ready to castle, like, maybe it takes and queen d7 or queen d6 and castle, brings in the knight.
Maybe he checked this with the engine and he found some crazy idea, but I'm not sure because I wasn't really sure if this was...
I don't think e5. After e5, I'm pretty sure he has no more prep.
Yeah, I mean, I think Black can even just castle here if he wanted to, and if White takes on f7, we take with the rook, and, I mean, it just seems like White's king is a bit underdeveloped to play this way.
Yeah. It was either prep or some aggressive playing. I think that this isn't 100% sound, but maybe he's just playing this to get a time advantage so he can try to outplay Krilla in an interesting position. So f6! That's a surprise.
That's ambitious. That is ambitious. He wants to play queen d6 and munch.
Apparently, he didn't like f takes e6 for some knight e4 reasons and knight g5, h4 reasons. And apparently, he didn't decide to go for castles, maybe because of knight g5 followed by knight f7. So he might not like those positions very much, so he just plays f6 and queen d6 and say, I'm okay.
Yeah, I'm sure he has something against knight d4, maybe knight b6.
Yeah.
Knight d4, knight b6.
Oh, wait, I need to take a little break. I need to get something.
You're good, Christopher. No worries. Knight takes c6 there. We just take with the knight. And queen has to move. Black's queen comes out. I mean, seems okay for black. I don't know. I mean,
yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's still unclear what white has accomplished by not having the d4 in the play. So his bishop is out of play. And both of his bishops are actually out of play. So
yeah,
he really needs to do something quick here, or otherwise black will consolidate and take his initiative.
Yeah, it's not an easy line to play with white, because a lot of times the computer is very, let's say, optimistic about it. But if you misplay it, you know, even one wrong move, it's like, yeah, queen on c4 doesn't make any sense with the bishop on f1, bishop on c1 is blocked. It's just not... I don't know. I mean, a lot of times what turns out is that none of white's pieces really achieve much, and then black kind of takes the initiative over because the Grünfeld is so aggressive.
Yeah. h4, wow. So, yeah, he's... I'm not really sure that... I'm still questioning this idea of the sacrifice a little bit because of this queen to d6 move, queen e2, knight f4, queen g4, f5. Just try getting this d6 pawn. So I really don't know how white doesn't lose a pawn.
Knight b6, maybe almost losing a piece immediately. Or is it even losing a piece? Because...
And actually, guys, we have a juicy scoop here. You know, apparently, so Christian is playing from the house of Arun Sharma, who used to run the U.S. Chess League. You know, they're roommates, so that makes sense. But also playing from the same house is Jeffrey Zhang of Dallas. Thanks for the tip from FPON in the chat. Arun just posted this photo on Facebook with Christian and Jeffrey basically playing on the same table but for opposite teams. So that is quite something. Of course, they're not going to face each other in the match, but that would be really awkward if they had to.
Yeah.
Very, very cool.
You know, kicking their opponent's legs at the table. None of that.
Yeah, at some point we got a message, Christopher or Christian, to like just close Jeffrey's laptop. You know, at a critical moment.
Unplug the battery.
Yeah, just pull the internet in the house. You know, some sabotage.
Yeah, quickly win his game and then go to the internet.
No, yeah, finish his game, offer a draw, and then disconnect the internet. Yeah, that would be something. I'm sure the league wouldn't overturn the result.
Yeah, of course.
I think I like Daniel's position. He has these two strong knights. Note that then both of them aren't actually real outposts because they can be attacked by a pawn. This can be attacked by an f pawn, and this can be attacked by a b pawn. So if you're wondering about definitions of outposts, but I mean they're strong knights is all I have to say. So black played a smart move, knight e5, to try to get this c5 knight off.
Yeah, and if white takes twice on e4, black will play queen takes b2 and infiltrate into white's position. Not very comfortable there for white. Yeah, I'd say I feel like white is slightly more comfortable here. Just the knight on e5 makes a nice impression. Could we see a move like b4 here? Does b4 make sense? Or is it too risky?
I'm pretty sure that's what he's thinking.
Maybe...
Or maybe takes first. Oh, no. Takes first and then... Rook b1, but that would lose to queen takes d4.
Right. D4 pawn would be hanging. I don't know. I mean, I think white is more comfortable here. Maybe even taking and a move like queen d2, and then even g4, g5.
Yeah.
Okay, it's black quest to prove that his bishop on e8 can get some activity in this position.
Yeah. So Daniel's looking to massage his opponent out in a nice fashion. Let's take a look at Mamadiarov's game.
Okay, jump back to Mamadiarov's game with the f3 Nimzo. Go back a little bit. We did have an exchange on d5, a4. And... get a very unbalanced structure and an exchange sacrifice. Looks like temporary. Wins it back. Bishop e3, knight d7. Comfortable position for white. I like the dark squared bishop here.
Yeah. I prefer right here. I mean, it's just a normal position with a two bishop advantage. But my question is, how is Mamadeyev going to react against d4? Maybe he's just going to play knight to a4, and if knight to b3, queen to d1, and if knight e5, bishop takes c4? Is that what he's going to do? What he's going to do, I don't know. But b4 is certainly something to calculate and keep in mind. Yeah. At some point, maybe Black's going to play knight e5 and maybe think of b4. So it's always in the air in this position. So as Wu Feng thinks about his position,
looks like he's calculating exactly that, I would assume. Yeah, this is really about whether or not Black can get enough activity here to kind of compensate for the slightly weak structure.
Yeah.
And b4 is on the board.
B4. I said it. Push the pawns. But you saw the variation I was mentioning?
I did. Maybe I played it on the board so the online audience can see it as well.
Maybe knight a4, knight b3, queen d1, there's knight to a5. So instead, maybe white should play queen a2. But still, knight a5, bishop takes c4, b3. So White will have to figure out how to get past this obstacle.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's super important for White to win the c4 pawn. A lot of times, he's just playing for a structural advantage. As we see knight b1, trying to reroute the knight to d2.
This is a superhuman move by Mamadeyev. I think that this pawn might be falling, because first of all, if queen to b5, knight d2, followed by bishop takes c4, and if knight to b3, just let's say queen a2, and if you play queen b5, queen takes b3, threatening bishop takes c4. I mean, knight b1, what a move. And if knight to e5, I mean, you can take the knight on c5 and play f4, and then take on c4. So a very nice move, knight b1, that we should have considered.
Yeah, I like this knight b1 move, I think. And, you know, even he doesn't even have to play knight d2 so quickly. He can just first bring his rook to c1 in a lot of lines, assuming he doesn't get hit with knight b3. As we see knight b3 on the board, queen a2. And let's hope for queen b5 here, guys, huh? Come on, queen b5.
Queen c7.
Queen c7, knight d2, just simple stuff. Knight takes d2, bishop takes d2, c3, b takes c3, b takes c3, rook c1. Done. Mm-hmm. So just knight d2. Let me play that on the board. That's my guess. Yes, I made the right guess.
Nice. Knight d2. And it seems like Black doesn't have enough time to bring his bishop to b7 and trap White's queen on the a-file with rook a8. So we see the exchange of knights. And Black's pawns are a bit overextended.
Yeah. We'll see if he can... b4 hanging. Yeah. I said the variation c3, b takes c3, b takes c3, rook c1, if you're wondering. And if you take the bishop, you can take the queen on c7, and the bishop on e2 is defending the queening square. So, of course, White's just completely winning.
Yeah.
b3 last ditch attempt to kind of save the pawn, but even then it's positionally disgusting for like maybe just queen a3, then knight b6, he can play rook c1. No, queen takes b3 threatened, he's going to play bishop e3. The long diagonal on a1 to h8 is really bad. So
wait, play c3 anyways.
Rook c1, knight c5. Yeah, he realizes he's not going to hold the pawn, so he just gives it up, tries to play for a solid position. He's probably going to try to play f5 in the near future, get some activity.
Yeah, so get some practical drawing chances.
But you know, we're going to... Sorry, go ahead, Timo.
Yeah, I mean, still, d6 is a weakness. Now, the bishop on c3 is a monster with the long diagonal. the knight on c5 looks good, but it's actually not that stable because white may have ideas with e5 in the near future.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the whole match we've seen actually this dark sword bishop dominating all the games. Like Jeffrey Zhang and Mamed Yarov in his other game both had the queen on a1, b2, and we're going to see it again here.
Yeah.
So let's see. Let's go to. Let's see how Ivan is doing real quick.
Have we looked at that game at all, actually?
No, we haven't. They had a kind of a late start, but it looks like they had a Queen's Gambit declined, Bishop f4, and...
So Ivan going for his usual, then b6, variations to get the hanging pawns, as he has had multiple times in this league, actually.
Right.
Oh, he just won an exchange.
He did. Now, the question is, does White have a lot of compensation here?
The answer is yes, I think, because I see d7 is next. And if rook to d8, I mean, at least... Okay, bishop takes f6, queen f5. White has a lot of compensation. The d6 pawns is looking to go to d7, and maybe queen f5 and bishop d3 is probably White's idea.
Yeah, queen f5 is a very strong move here. Probably just a very bad position for Black, and queen f5 is of course on the board.
Yeah, the threat of just bishop d3 is so strong.
I want to switch to Daniel's game here. Looks like Jeffrey Zhang has snagged a pawn somewhere and has just come in with queen c2, trying to trade queens and go into this endgame. Very interesting. I wonder, queen e3 is on the board, and I wonder if Daniel is looking to simply sacrifice on h6 and go for the attack.
Rook c1 is threatened, and the queen is trapped. So rook c1, queen takes b2, then rook takes a4, just winning a piece.
Mm-hmm.
So not that simple for Jeffrey, but the bishop will likely move to maybe b5, actually.
Right, bishop b5 looks like the move. And then maybe... Well, the problem with this sacrifice is it probably has to take on
h6.
On f6. Well, I don't know. Maybe it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Both are coming with check. But whenever the queen comes to h6, Black has this e3 shot at any point to just open up his queen for the defense.
So I'm really questioning a little bit about how Daniel was going to go forward with this position. Maybe he's just looking to play rook e1 and then take on e4. That might as well be his best try, so I'm not really a big fan of that. Mamedov, nothing really happening there, just a normal situation. Krilla, it's been a while.
So, all right, let's switch to Christian's game. And
okay, bishop e3. I'm not sure if I really like his position so much. First of all, if Black takes the pawn on e6, d5, and then he wins this knight,
knight b4. Black has played knight b4 now.
Yeah, I know. This game reminds me of the round one game where Shaq kind of did the same thing to Chris Tuohon and had very aggressive play from White, and then gets out of it, and White is left with a bunch of weaknesses in the position, as we see knight takes d4. So, going for complications here is Christian. Trade on d4, now we would expect maybe either hg6, or even h6, or rook d1. So, White is going to be looking for some compensation here for the pawn deficit.
Yeah, rook d1, I think that he was looking to get his rook on d7 and his knight on d5 and bring all his pieces in and try to build the compensation needed for a pawn deficit.
Yeah, maybe queen e5 here is possible. Not sure.
Yeah, queen e5 might as well be Krilla's idea. But, queen c5 is another idea, so he's willing to let White play a move like rook d7 or take the pawn followed by queen e4. in queen h4, so apparently he thinks that he can defend the attack. Wow. Sharp stuff. Maybe his idea after queen e4 is to play f5 followed by bishop takes c3, which actually makes a lot of sense. So, wow, he's thinking that he can defend this. Interesting. A very sharp position. Queen e4, okay. F5, queen h4, bishop takes c3, king f1 might be an idea. Maybe king g7 then? Very sharp stuff.
We're getting a lot of love on Twitter, you guys, from people watching, tuning into the show. Very, very happy with our commentary thus far. And let's switch actually back to Daniel's game. A tip from Judith, who is one of the managers for the San Jose Hackers and does not lead us wrong.
Wait, I don't think rook AA1 was good. I was thinking of C4. Mm-hmm. Then if bishop takes, you have the pin with rook AC3. And if rook takes, then you have... Then I was thinking of rook AA1, but I guess he doesn't want to give up the pawn. But no, bishop d3, no c3 is hanging anyways.
Yeah.
So I think Daniel's kind of starting to lose the thread here. Now he might be looking at the knight takes f6 or knight takes h6.
Yeah. I'd imagine. I mean, both sides are down to 3 minutes now, and it's now or never, it looks like, because this bishop is covering the b1 square. I mean, there's no rook b1, of course, and c3 pawn is about to fall, so got a sack. maybe he's, I mean, probably concerned about black playing e3 and including his bishop in the defense. We saw this idea earlier, also hitting f2. This is working so much for white, so maybe he's trying to find a way to improve on the sack and make it work somehow.
I mean, maybe he's considering this move f3 to play f takes e4 next, and then sack.
Yeah, he's down 2 pawns, so he has to complicate it somehow. F3 makes sense. But there's so much to calculate.
D5.
I was briefly considering this move, but I wasn't expecting him to actually play it. I think that Daniel might just be thinking of playing queen d4 next. But what's he going to do after queen b5 is the question, so...
Well, queen d4. So it's just a positional sack. D5 gets the d4 square for the queen. Now this pawn is hanging with check.
But he's down 3 pawns, and if queen b4, I mean, what's he going to do? I mean, if...
Wait, queen b5, you mean? Then probably knight e3 would come. Queen b6 is... Jeff is giving up 1 pawn, but he's still up 2. So now Daniel really needs to get his queen and knight to coordinate well, but I don't think he has sufficient compensation.
Yeah, meanwhile, Shaq has won on top board against Rufeng Li. Looks like he ended up with an extra piece.
And we also have Ivan losing against... Conrad Holt.
So Ivan did lose to Conrad Holt, and now we have 2 games left. Christian is defending against Tulin here after this move, knight d5, actually. It's very concerning. His e7 pawn is hanging. Queen a6 check looks to be the only move. King g2. And black is under pressure here, but if he can get out of this, I mean, he's up a lot of material.
Wow, this position is scary. I mean, white has been playing this game well. What should Tristan do? I'm still wondering what the good defense is. Because if he plays rook e8, knight takes c7.
Mm-hmm.
I'm concerned. I sort of one fella to just hold this game.
There's also ideas of rook h8 here. I mean, white's queen is trapped in the long run, so we'll see.
Rook a, it does reverse knight takes e7 is followed by just simply rook h8.
Mm-hmm. So knight e7, rook h8. But what about knight c7?
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. Knight takes c7.
Yeah, knight c7. I think he just has to give up the exchanges. Maybe just queen takes a2.
Yeah, but I mean, he has one pawn for it, so there's some hope left.
Wait, does he? I think he has two.
No, he has one.
Well, if he takes on a2, he's winning some pawns.
Oh, yeah, takes on a2, so certainly a lot of hope there for both sides. So Krilla with some good defensive technique. We're really stuck on this game.
Yeah, so Tulin here is trying to figure this out.
Daniel's game. Whoa, it's getting a little. It's getting a little sharper.
Yeah, I'd say so. Wow, knight d5 again, threatening the sacks on f6 here. Not to mention that white's rook on a3 is just hanging. Whew, man, I mean, if white picks up the b4 pawn, I mean, he must be doing good here. He defends c6. He has the whole position under control. So Jeffrey Zhang, I mean, I don't like this position, actually. You know, I was thinking maybe Jeffrey wins this one and Christian wins on board 3, but it could be the other way around, actually.
Mm-hmm.
This is looking good for white. Maybe he's considering some kind of queen sacrifice. Queen c5.
Queen takes c5 makes it very sharp, but note the time situation. Jeffrey Zhang is going under 45 seconds right now, so.
Yeah, this is suddenly looking good, very good for us. You know, just a couple of moments ago, Daniel Netter was completely losing, I think. Mm-hmm. It's maybe was it 2 points down, but now he's just 1 point down and amazing positional control.
I mean, knight takes b4. Yeah, I mean, I love this position for white. The c6 pawn is so strong. Quickly, Christian has drawn his game. I like that result for us because
I think that's good. You know, he was so low on time, down in exchange, but, you know.
Queen h4 was played. It seems like white offered a draw here. And I would say it's probably pretty balanced endgame. I mean, white has some weaknesses. The bishop is going to be excellent on f6.
But look at 7.6 seconds for Krilla. I think that he probably should have went for the win.
That's not a lot of time, right?
Now we have Jeffrey Zhang under 20 seconds going all in with e3.
Wow, rook c8. Amazing.
So this is do or die for both players.
So c7, and now this bishop on d3 is hanging, but of course rook on c5 is also hanging.
Well, but
are we going to have queen d8 check, guys? Oh my god. Knight d3, takes, and queen d8.
Queen d8.
Oh, let's go, Daniel. D8. Come on, pull it off.
And now there's king h7, queen takes c8.
Oh no, queen takes f8, rook d3.
Queen f8, rook d3.
Daniel.
Oh, that's good. Come on, Daniel. Rook d3.
I mean, rook d3 also wins. Yeah, he's going to do what
d3.
I
say.
A3, and rook d8.
Rook d8. Looks like we got
to
win.
That was a really nice comeback.
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful.
The advantage. Wow.
Daniel Naroditsky.
Daniel.
Huge win over Jeffrey Zhang, giving us the round and our first lead of the match. 2.5, 1.5, going into what's going to be a very hotly contested round 4. Wow, amazing. Amazing. For those of you who just tuned in to the show based on all the feedback on Twitter, you guys just watched probably one of the most exciting moments of our season so far, I have to say. That was incredible. Very nice win by Daniel. This D5 move. I'm going to say right now, come on guys, move of the week, D5, I'll rewind it back. That's what gave white, you know, kind of the swing in this game to really infiltrate black's position.
Yeah, but I think also black's response to D5 was somewhat unexpected or maybe even a bit dubious, because taking it does give white some really nice coordination, especially like B5 just gives white an unnecessary passport. So black is went downhill from there. But if he just reacts calmly to d5, maybe just playing queen b6, if you're looking at that version, queen b6 mm-hmm. makes a lot of sense. Instead right. of taking, giving back one pawn, but then white is just left so many weaknesses. Bishop on d3 is a monster. c3 is hanging. The rooks on c8 and potentially open a-file are so much better than white's rooks.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, the king just marches to e7, takes the e6 pawn back, and I think black should be on his way to win.
Yeah, an instructive error by Jeffrey Zhang that Tibu just pointed out.
Yeah, and I don't think it.
Don't let your opponent get
particular move. It was that he was consistently going for the wrong strategy rather than you know playing it safe and.
Not letting your opponent get any counterplay in good positions is an important factor. And that's what Timu saw with this queen b6 move. Maybe Jeffrey Zhang just missed it, so.
Well, you know, in the heat of the battle, I mean, of course, they're already pretty low on time at that point. It's very, very hard to make a complicated decision like that. But yeah, I'm sure Jeffrey is kicking himself after that game because that is definitely not a game he should be losing. He was, I think we all agree, black had an enormous advantage there at some point.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, I'm trying to update the score, and all of these are going to be different sizes. So if there's anyone with OCD watching, I do apologize for that. I know that is not pleasant to see.
You'll be using my spreadsheet. It's so much easier. Oh no, that's not so bad to look at.
I'll do my best to fix it. We have 5 minutes until the next round here, and
I need to stretch.
Some yoga with Christopher.
Yeah, Christopher is pulling the heavy labor so far, doing a lot of excellent commentary tonight, sir.
Yeah.
And the critical round 4 will be decisive. So I just want to remind everyone that we need to win the match outright. An 8-8 tie means that Dallas will be advancing considering their higher seeding. So that means in this final round, we need to go 2-2 or better to clinch our next spot in the playoffs.
Oh, this is nerve-wracking.
Also,
I really don't want to jinx it here, but I think Ivan has excellent chances against Tulin, and then, Naroditsky against Lee. That should be about equal or about even. Mamed Yarov should handle Jeffrey without any problems, and Kirill Lahold is something to look forward to also. But, I think we should have this. Don't want to jinx it, though.
Yeah, this is going to be the round where one plays one, two plays two. So it's going to be just board by board matchups. I mean, I have to say we should have at least a small edge on board one, although I'm not sure about the colors. I think Jeffrey Zhang might get white against Shaq, so that'll kind of equalize that a little bit.
Yes, black.
Sorry, who gets black?
I think, Mamed Yarov just played white, so, oh yeah. I can see on place, white.
And board 4 will also be critical, as Ivan is a rating underdog to Chris Tulin, but, I mean, Ivan is very careful. I mean, capable. He's beaten Teddy Coleman earlier in the season, who's, like, got 200, 250 points on him. So I think if Ivan gets a nice position, I think he's not shy about delivering the upset there. And on board 3, we'll have Christian playing against Conrad, so another kind of even matchup. I feel like, personally, Christian has played a little bit better than Conrad this season. I mean, I haven't followed Conrad's play too closely, but I like Christian's chances there. So, yeah, I mean, we've got a good chance, but still a lot of chess to be played, and it's gonna be nerve-wracking. Let's put it that way. Nothing's over until it's over. Not even close.
Dan, you scored a critical win for us this last match.
Yeah, that was, I mean, very, very clutch win, I have to say. At some point, Daniel just kind of turned up the gear and just started playing beautiful chess to really overturn that that position. Meanwhile, I've equalized the sizing of my scoring. Just did it the old-fashioned way. I mean, they're not exactly, they're kind of lined up. All right, I'll call that good enough. And the next round will be starting momentarily.
It's 8:30, so it's gonna start very soon. Let's check if it started. I don't see the games yet, but they're gonna start very soon. Still hasn't started yet, if you're wondering. A really close playoff match.
Very close. But you know, I am Danny Wrench. He did his bracket live on air a couple days ago. He picked us to win this match against Dallas. He really likes our lineup. He knows we've had the toughest strength of schedule in the whole league. Our tiebreaks are great. He picked us to win, and then he picked us to win next week as well against Webster, who's already seeded into the second round due to them having an excellent regular season. So I am very appreciative of Danny's confidence in our team, and I like to see our guys finish strong here as well.
Yeah. Still waiting. They're gonna start very soon, so be patient.
And the chat is going crazy. Shout out right now to some members of Bay Area Chess who are just joining in for the final round. Looks like we have Mr. Vinesh in the chat as well as Sanat. These guys are on the elite team. They are coached by Daniel Naroditsky and Christian, as of course are my co-commentators. So they'll be rooting for their coaches here, and hopefully not trolling too much in the Twitch chat.
I still don't see our game starting yet, and it's a few minutes past schedules.
Oh, here we go. We got the top board, Jeffrey Zhang playing e4 against Mamedjarov. Are we gonna see d6 like he's been playing in almost every other game?
Oh yeah, I see the game, so I
know. No, solid. He's
okay.
He shows that. Jeffrey some respect by playing e5 and not his typical d6. And we have a classical Ruy Lopez.
Wait, I'm just trying to get all the games. There. So Daniel's game is starting. So it looks, yeah, it's a classical Roy Lopez with d4.
So fun fact about this d4 opening, this is something Jeffrey has played a lot in the past. And in fact, he lost a very decisive and critical game in this line to a certain player in the St. Louis Invitational a few years ago in round one. I remember that game very, very well. Because I was
Kostya Kamitsky.
That's right. Against me. So I'm sure he's since improved on that game. Actually, he was completely winning there. I think we had some sharp endgame where I ended up winning. But I would bet that he has very serious nightmares about that game still. Hopefully, Shock used that game to prepare, is going to be using that in this round as well.
Wow, I surprised. Guess that you play well again in these traditional lines. I think I played a good game against you. So we have some c5, some sharp boy Lopez stuff. D4 is sharper than what I do here, which is h3. So he goes for the sharp thing, bishop e3, normal stuff, and c5. This is known to be a little more sharper than the other line. So we'll take a look at Daniel's game.
Yeah, Daniel is playing against board 2, Rufeng Li. I'm going to switch over there. And he's got black as well.
Yeah. So it's a French, and it looks like some sort of trash clothes, more like a trash. But I don't know the ideas of this line. I don't play the trash, I play knight c3, so...
Well, white is trying to get just a comfortable little space advantage. This b6, a5 idea, it's kind of more new agey in the French. And we're going to get this very stodgy position. Where
all I know is that black played this normal bishop a6 idea because he wants to trade off his bad bishop. The downside of that is that it takes a little bit of time. All I know is that white has a space advantage, but I don't really know the theory here. Because I never played the trash before.
Yeah, it's an interesting line for black. I mean, white really has to know what he's doing on the king side, find the right attacking plan. Otherwise, yeah, black has traded off his problem bishop and is going to feel pretty comfortable here if white doesn't get the initiative. So it's an ambitious choice by Daniel, that's for sure.
So...
I actually want to jump to Ivan's game because he's played the f3 Nimzo, aka the Shak Mamedyarov, and c5, d5. These guys are also kind of following very similar to the Wesley So game from last week. We've got exchanges on d5, and actually knight takes d5. Nice little trick based on e takes d5, queen h4 check, winning back the bishop on c4. So... white took on d5 with the bishop, pawn takes, queen takes d5, castles. And Chris Toulon falls for the same blunder as Wesley So did last week, hanging his rook on a8 in the hopes that he's going to be able to trap white's queen. Knight e2 was played, queen b6, bishop e3. So Ivan just does not take the rook. Bishop b7 and queen d2.
And knight c6, so some tricky tactical tricks to begin this game by NM Chris Tool. So we'll certainly be looking closely at this game. It's a sharp position. He might think of knight a5 and knight c4, as happened in the Wesley So game. Queen takes c3, I mean just d6 and bishop a6. I mean, I'm not sure about the position. I think that it's a double-edged position.
Definitely. I mean, structurally, white is better. You know, he has pressure against c5. He's going to have pressure against the d-pawn.
He has this e4 fe g2 setup that usually goes well against the b7 bishop, but... Black has this additional a6 square for his bishop and could even think of knight a5 and followed by knight c4 after playing d6. Sort of those ideas improving the knight, so I don't think that the fe4 g2 setup against the b7 bishop exactly is so useful here.
Yeah, so gonna be very, very interesting this game as we see d6 on the board. Will Ivan castle queenside or will he be solid and go kingside?
I think he might be thinking about king f2 actually.
None of the above. King f2 is not bad.
I mean, the problem with castling immediately is that there might be bishop a6 and simply exchanging off the white knight on e2. And then Black's weaknesses aren't that big, actually, because you know there's the, it's difficult to pressure as d6. Black will have his own counterplay against b2.
Yeah, I mean, but king f2, of course, runs into f5.
But you still have f3 there. And f5, you just take, you could quick counterplay against d6.
Take, and rook d1, yeah?
But then d5, I mean.
Well, c5 will hang.
Dan is rolling. Knight to g3, d4, queen c4, rook f7. Dan, he's ready to try to win the San Jose Hackers. Wow. Dan's going to be the hero, I guess, right?
Wait, which game are you talking about, Chris?
No, Chris Toole. Takes rook takes f5, rook ad1, d5, Dan needs a d-pawn.
But the c5 pawn will be hanging there. Yeah. So, okay, just castles from Ivan. We'll see if he goes for this bishop a6. I mean, I feel like white will definitely be better there. I like the dark squared bishop in the structure quite a bit. So he'll play rook e1 and then take on e2 and put his rook on d2, put the other rook on d1.
Yeah. It's just a regular position. So he goes for Timu's idea, which is taking on e2 and then maybe even thinking about taking on e2 for playing knight e5 and getting a fine position, because maybe the knight on e2 can do stuff like knight g3, knight f5. So he wants to get rid of this bishop because it's not like his a6 bishop is such a good piece. I mean, it's not a great piece, and I think that I'd rather prefer the e2 knight than the a6 bishop, right?
I don't know. I mean, the bishop isn't great, and you know, white's knight is in danger of going to f4 and d5. So from black's perspective, having played bishop a6, of course, now he is kind of committed to taking. Having said a, he must say b. But I mean, I don't know. I like Ivan's position a lot, and I feel like he feels pretty comfortable here too. So let's see. I'm gonna go to Christian's game here because Conrad has been playing very, very sharp from the opening. We've got this c4 and kind of a ready setup against Conrad's favorite Slav defense. White wins back the pawn eventually with his knights. And now this early h5 from black, which Conrad played quickly. So, I mean, definitely an idea he's maybe seen before and in similar positions. But I don't know. I have to say, I feel like white has a lot of... I feel like the center is far too open for this to really be all that great for black. I mean, takes on g3. Now Christian is deciding whether he should just take with the h-pawn. And, okay, he does after some thought.
Yeah. I mean, black might even consider the move bishop h3. Here trying to get the g2 bishop, but an issue with that might be this obstacle of queen to c4.
So queen c4, yeah. Interesting move.
He has to figure out how to deal with that.
So if black plays e6 here,
then bishop takes e6, b takes e6, queen takes e6, king f8. So I guess that's your idea, right? You're gonna escape with your king.
Yeah, you know, maybe white can simply trade on h3 and play king g2, and next move rook h1, and oops, it's white who has the h-file here.
No. I have another idea. It's to play knight takes c6, because if you take, I can just play bishop takes c6, and that should be good. I mean,
that's true. Even queen takes c6, pick up the rook on a8. I like Christian's position here, and I don't see exactly what Conrad is playing for. Okay. Let's jump to Daniel's game. So Daniel has ended up castling kingside, usually pretty risky here, but Rufeng is going for the attack, knight h5. And this is one of those crazy French positions. Sorry?
How does white actually get through here? Because you know, there are no sacrifices on g7 that light or the dark squares are in control. The knight on h5 is just blocking h5, and even if he does get h5, the knight will happily go back to f8, and I don't see much for white.
Yeah, I mean that's a question we're gonna pose to Rufeng Li, because well, if white doesn't succeed on the king side, I mean black has some serious positional chances on the queen side. This is typical French, yeah.
From knight a6, knight b4, maybe knight a6, bishop b4, doubling rooks on the c-file.
Wait, I have this idea for white that I think that's very interesting. Bishop to h6, bishop to, and then if you take, queen takes h6, and the bishop f8, knight f6.
That's annoying.
But then the problem might be just move bishop to f8, and I'm still trying to get past. What I'm thinking about then is to play a move like, let's say even knight takes g7, as crazy as it might sound. The idea is bishop takes g7, h takes g7, king takes g7, h5. But I don't think that's really good, right? I mean, you're just going to get the piece back in that position, so.
Hard to believe.
Yeah, I mean, bishop h6, it's a good effort, but I don't see the way how it actually breaks through because of just calm bishop to f8, so it was just an interesting variation that I wanted to share.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what Rufeng is probably considering in these positions. You know, this is a sharp stuff. I remember international master David Pruis actually was doing commentary for Chess TV. He once told me he doesn't like playing against the French so much because sometimes, you know, white gets one concrete chance to get the initiative, and if he doesn't find it, well, here we go, bishop h6 is on the board. If he doesn't find it, then it's black who kind of takes over the position. So we'll see what Rufeng has calculated here. He's a very dangerous player. I've seen him sacrifice a lot of pieces in his career, and bishop h6 is on the board.
I had some different ideas besides bishop takes g7, like, but they didn't seem to actually make. I was thinking about knight to f6, g takes f6, bishop takes f8, followed by taking on f6 ideas, but I just saw queen d8, and just this is nothing.
Yeah, the Windows notifications you guys are hearing, that's from my desktop Twitter. So a lot of Twitter notifications today from people watching the match all over the world and the Pro League.
Now, let's take a look at Ivan's game. So it looks like he managed to seemingly win the c5 pawn, I guess.
Well, we had the exchange on e2. b4 was played, which is a really nice move. And now rook c2. So this pawn is just pinned in all sorts of places.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like he's just going to get the c5 pawn, and then he's going to play rook to c1. I mean, white. I like white.
Yeah,
he's going to be able to pawn.
Is there any way to save? Save the pawn?
No, I don't see it. Well, you could think of knight d4, but that doesn't save the pawn. So,
no,
I don't see
knight
it.
Knight d4 is just bad, because you take it and you still have the d6 weakness.
Yeah. I mean, there's no way to save a pawn, is what I mean. No way to save.
I guess he's thinking about maybe a rook fc8, b takes c5, and maybe just knight e5 or knight a5.
Mm-hmm.
Try to use a pinned advantage.
I was sort of thinking about that, but like then queen to d4, and if knight to a5, knight to a5, I'd probably play queen to b4.
Right, queen b4, solid move.
That's a nice move, yeah. I mean, still rook fc8, I mean, might be the best practical choice.
It seems like the only reasonable move in the position. Just line the get the rook in the game. Let's see.
Maybe he even has to go for something passive with knight d8 to knight e6. Assume some defense and then try to hold it. Maybe, distract White's forces on c5, so you get maybe the second rank for your queen rook.
Mm-hmm.
That would be what Black really wants.
Well, we'll see. I mean, I really like our chances here. I'm going to jump to actually Mamadiaro's game, because we haven't checked this one at all. Meanwhile, some craziness on Daniel's game, but we'll get back to that. It seems like Mamadiaro has comfortably equalized with this bishop on c5. Jeffrey's going a little bit down on time, but should be a pretty safe position for White. But I really like our chances here on this one. At least feels very, very safe. And let's switch back to Rufeng's game, because this is, I mean, if Daniel holds against this attack, looks like he has accepted the sacrifice.
98.
This is going to be,
Knight g5, take the bishop, bishop takes g5, and then just saying that there's no more attack.
Bishop g5 takes, and
queen e7.
Have to play queen e7 to challenge White's queen, otherwise knight f6 is a problem.
And then queen f8, so I think Daniel's holding.
Mm-hmm.
I would say so, but you never know with Rufeng. I've seen him, he has a lot of these attacks, and he has a good experience here, and like just finding tricks in complicated positions, especially with the time situation as it is. Like the Daniel's up 2 minutes. Right now, the match is looking good, but there so much can happen here. You know, it's gonna be sharp. Meanwhile, let's go to Christian's game. He's shoved his pawn to d5, where it can be taken by two of the enemy pawns. So this is either some kind of strange blunder or a pretty straightforward pawn sacrifice.
my answer is I think it's a
pawn. Oh, wait, isn't that a blunder? Because now you have queen c5 check, exactly. King g8, bishop takes g7, king takes g7, queen d4, just wins a
piece.
Nice.
Wow, he just learned just a blunder, but Conrad hold. So d5 was actually an excellent move, because now
fantastic move.
The points on pawn. But now also there's threats of d takes e6. So I think d5 might be the move of the week.
I think d5 is an amazing move. Greg, if you're watching, you know, the move of the week right here, d5. Look at these tactics. Can't take on b2 because queen b2 hits the rook on h8. This poor rook that Conrad never castled with, but developed down the h-file. And after bishop takes g7...
Sad move.
Oh, the saddest move I've ever seen in my life, to be honest. Just bring the bishop back. I mean, the only reason Conrad is playing on here is, of course, because of the team situation. I mean, this is the last round. You have to play things out all the way to the end. You never know. I mean, Christian could get an internet disconnection, blunder, mouse slip, something, you never know.
Also get that disconnection.
Of course, we're hedged against that, because Jeffrey would also also be losing his game. Well, I mean, fantastic move d5 by Christian. I expect wherever he is right now, he's clapped his hands together, because he's happy with that move.
He's spending his time here.
Well, I think he wants to be very, very precise. He doesn't want to give Black any chances whatsoever. Let's go back to Jeffrey's game. There's hanging rooks on the board, knight e4, rook d4. And Shock has a choice here of whether he can take the rook and take on b2. But then rook c4.
Why not?
Looks like White will win back the pawn.
Yeah, but that seems like just a drawn position, so... This game, I'm calling it a draw, I think.
Yeah, I think he's probably taking his time here to figure out whether he can play for more in the position. But, I mean, if he takes a look at the other games, he'll realize that he probably doesn't need to. I mean, Christian is up a piece. Yeah. Ivan was doing great. Daniel's also up a piece, although that game is obviously much more complicated. And yeah, great comment in the chat by Mr. Ford 13. Daniel also played this d5 move to create some real chances in his game last round against Jeffrey. So this d5 is the hacker's move of the week, that's for sure.
Let's take a look at
Shark taking d4.
Conrad Holt, he's not giving up. He wants to play queen h5. So if I was Tristan, I would just play f3 and king f2. No counterplay. Right?
I hope so. Yeah, f3, the diagonal is covered. King f2, rook h1. And there we go, f3.
Bishop h3, king f2. Queen f2.
Queen f2, ultra solid. Ultra solid. I have a feeling at the BAC Elite Team class this week, Christian and Daniel are going to be showing these two games where they played d5 to to win the match.
that'll be what they'll be teaching us. D5, what is the best move in this position?
Yeah, you guys have an unfair advantage, seeing I say you witnessed it firsthand. But you'll know right away the kids who didn't follow the show, because they'll be struggling to find the right move.
Yeah. E4, Trilla's just finishing off the... Conrad Holt, look at how serious he is. Look at that photo. He's very concerned about his team situation right now. I think that he looks just like that right now. That's how he feels.
Also look at Christian's time, 2 minutes and 7 minutes. That's a bit concerning, even though he's up a piece, you know, a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah, I don't like that he has 2 minutes, but it's very hard to... I mean, there's not like Black has some... serious tricks here. It's only I think Christian should be able to win this as long as he just keeps his nerves in check. You know, trades on h3, plays king g2 soon. There shouldn't be any mishaps, and eventually rook h1 and checkmate on h8. I think that's how he's going to get the job done.
Yeah, a very straightforward plan, but a good one. Let's take a look at Mamadeov's trying to do something with f5, but I still think that this is going to be a draw. He could think of king knight to g3 followed by bishop to h6, g5, but if he sees the same situation, he'll probably just simply trade and go for a draw. Yeah, I think he knows the team situation. Oh, knight takes d- no. Sorry, I freaked out because I saw knight takes d2, rook e8, king d1, rook d8, but of course the bishop's hanging, so I think that he's just bailing out because of the team situation.
Yeah, and objectively, probably there's not much Black can really play for here. I think now Jeffrey's deciding which piece to take, the bishop on f4 or the knight on d2. He takes on f4, and if knight e4, probably White has to play g4 here in order to break his rook. Oh no, we see knight d2. So just going into this rook and pawn endgame, it seems.
Yeah, wait.
Probably rook b8 here is the safest way.
Oh yeah, you mean this. Yeah, so he's he plays rook b8, it's just to draw. Mamadeyev knows our team situation.
They'll probably agree to a draw soon. Even Mamadeyev in all his glory won't be playing this on. Declined the draw.
offers.
Yeah, it typically happens on chess.com. One side offers a draw, you don't see it, you make a move, and for some reason they don't understand why you're playing on. All right, I'm switching back to Rufeng's game. This is the critical game right now, because if Daniel survives this, I mean, that is basically just about clinching the match.
Looks like he is surviving this. He's got this good defensive knight on g6. He can just play queen e7, bishop g7, control f6, defend everything. I don't see how Rufeng's gonna make his attack work. The big material deficit is why I like Daniel's position. And the time deficit, 2 minutes, a little more than 2 minutes versus almost 5 minutes. So, not comfortable time lead for Daniel. Nothing going wrong. When the rook takes c1, rook takes c1, rook a7, Daniel simplifying the position. As Krilla seems to be finishing things off on this board too. Right?
Here's hoping.
Wait, yeah. What if queen to d3, rook to e2, rook to g5. It's not that easy. I guess king f2. And then queen f3, and then, yeah. Oh, king g1 is played. Rook to g5, I think his idea is just to play g4. Right? And then play rook a, g, and then if rook g5, g4, rook a d1, bring the rook in, and he seems perfectly safe.
Yeah, still a little bit of work white needs to do here, but I think, okay, oh, rook d8's a tricky move, hoping for rook d1.
I think bishop f6 is a... Wait, bishop f6, rook d6, and then... This position's actually not that as easy as it looks, so...
Maybe just rook e2 here?
Yeah, I think that's the smart... A smart decision. Just don't let any counterplay control the second rank, and you shouldn't have any problems.
Yeah, this is gonna be tight.
Okay, rook c1. He wants to play rook c3. A good move by Krylov, knowing that team situation and not letting his opponent gain any counterplay, but some tough defense by Holt. So Mamadeo drew. Daniel seems to be winning.
Ivan
what about Ivan?
But yeah. It's not all that clear. He's down on time a little bit. And his opponent definitely has some compensation. The knight on e5 is quite annoying. Ready to jump for the d3.
Guys, I have to apologize. Not to the live audience that understands that currently we've got... We got someone on Twitter liking all the tweets just to get my notifications going. But I have to apologize to the audience watching this on demand later that is not going to understand why these annoying bells keep popping up. Yeah, just going down the list, liking all the tweets.
What if bishop d6 here?
Twitter chat to do that.
Yeah, what if bishop to d6 here?
Yeah, bishop d6 just seems it's just very straightforward.
Oh, queen d1, okay.
Okay, that makes sense also, but if bishop d6 works, then there's no reason to not play it.
Yeah.
So we're looking at Ivan's games?
Yeah.
Looks like he declined a draw. I think that's fair. He's up a pawn, very comfortable position.
Wait, something happened in Daniel's game. Wu Feng Li just took the pawn on h7. Knight takes h7. Some sharp stuff. Whoa. I guess his idea is if king takes h7, queen takes f7, bishop g7, it's knight f6, and if king h6, knight g4. But what if then king h5? It's scary, but I'm not exactly seeing how white can check.
Isn't there just queen takes g7 then?
King takes g4, queen takes g6, and then king to f3, and if queen to h5, king to e4. Now my only issue. Oh, but then queen d3.
So ooh, f5.
That's
yeah.
What a move.
Smart play by Nyadiski. Calculating king takes h7. Calculating king takes h7. So
knight f6, bishop h6. Man, guys, I've never seen superfluous knights like this one.
This is so strong. But queen h5, there's king g7.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh my god. Just, okay, king to g7, This Daniel's defense is freaking me out.
Daniel, as you guys know, he's written two books, one on complex endgames and one on mastering positional chess. In positional chess, he has a chapter on defense, you know, defending against these crazy sacrifices.
Did he just walk into a draw?
No, I think that he knows the team situation, so he's just gonna play it safe and draw, right?
Yeah, but like bishop takes g5 is just game over for white.
Yeah, maybe he could have taken on g5. But draw is fine. I mean, look, it's Ru Feng who's actually considering whether he needs to play on or not. In queen h5, he does. Oh my god.
Oh my god.
So he's not liking the position on the other board. So what's the threat here, guys?
I mean, no. Oh my god, don't fall for that. Just play queen to h8, and I think you're fine. Followed by bishop takes g5.
It looks so scary.
It looks scary, but after queen to h8, I'm not seeing immediately how white can take advantage of it.
I like this move. Queen h8, let's go, Danya. Let's go. I mean, if Danya wins this, knight e6?
Desperation.
Oh, wow. That's two pieces now. But now there's so many threats, like knight h5 and queen takes e6. Yeah.
Queen to c8, Daniel. Queen to c8. I know you can play it.
It's really dicey.
I mean, queen to... Oh my god. God, this is a sharp position.
Yeah, I don't... Oh man. Christian is down to just seconds, but it looks like he's... He's under control.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Queen f2. Queen f3. No draw.
Oh, man. I mean, we are all going for the draws.
Oh, and Christian has made a draw.
Wow.
He had to allow repetition because Black was getting... giving mate. Yeah.
Oh my god!
Roofing avoids repetition again.
Oh, queen g8, queen g8, please, queen g8.
Queen g8? Woo!
Yes, he found it. King h7.
It's just two pieces, right?
Yeah, just queen,
queen
g6.
Queen
g6, hold on.
But how many pawns did Roofing take in this match? Jeez.
Wow. I mean,
okay, knight takes d4.
Knight takes d4.
Okay, no, white.
Just go back to e6 and consolidate. Yeah, Daniels looks like he's gonna win this position.
Oh my god, do not take on a2.
He doesn't have much time. I think that, he decided.
Ivan is down to seconds as well. Ivan is doing good.
Really intense. Now, don't fall for... Wait, which game are you looking at?
Sorry, I'm back to Daniel's game.
Oh, Daniel's? I'm looking at Ivan's.
Oh my god, what is happening?
Oh no, Daniel just blundered.
Oh no.
No. Daniel
don't worry.
Ivan has to win.
Okay, we need Ivan to win, but okay, his position's looking good.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
His position's looking great, guys. If Ivan wins this,
Ivan has to win.
I will buy him a car. Oh my god. That's it.
Bishop b4. Okay, bishop e5.
Just queen. That's the match.
That's the match.
Okay, we're gonna watch Ivan play up a queen right now.
Yeah.
Ivan, just put the king on a8. Don't blunder any knight forks, please. Please. Bishop f6, come on.
Bishop f6.
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Okay, yes. You guys playing on.
Queen h5. Queen g3. Yeah, we made it.
Wow. What a finish. Unbelievable.
Oh my god.
Win once again.
So we won by the smallest margin.
Eight and a half, 7.5.
What an exciting match.
Amazing.
Daniel blunders to the last round. Wow.
Whew, it was hard to talk at the end there. I mean, I was just stunned by it. I mean, just the time, you know, is the...
Yeah, he went for the queen takes a2, which I think is a bit too risky, especially with solo on time. But okay, Ivan saved the match.
So the hackers win and advance to the next round. We will be playing Webster Windmills next Wednesday. I think the time is to be determined. Yeah. I did promise Ivan a car if he won that, so I'll be paying up on that.
Black had a win here with queen takes b3, queen f7, and knight f4 check. And if white takes the knight, queen takes f7 finishes it off. So, wow. What an exciting match. And We'll certainly be looking forward to commentating more matches like this. He almost got knocked out. Phew, we didn't. Thank you for watching.
Incredible. Wow, I mean, I'm just stunned. My heart rate is like 170. It's
maybe more.
Jeez, what a finish. Oh my god. Unbelievable. Very clutch by Ivan. I mean, Christian, you know, amazing he didn't win that game after such a beautiful move, d5. That would have just clinched the match right there. Wow, I mean, that was incredible. I mean, great job to the hackers. I mean, they pulled it off.
Great job. Oh my god, it came down to Ivan Key beating Adam Chris Tool. Wow. Amazing stuff.
Yeah.
What an exciting match. This could have gone either way in a lot of games.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, easily could have gone the other way. So, okay, I guess we'll wrap it up here. Thanks so much to everyone for tuning in. I mean, we've got 43 viewers. I mean, I think the most that we've had all night. Unfortunately, the match is over, so you guys missed the bulk of the action. But incredible. Thanks so much for everyone for tuning in. We will be posting recaps, of course, and the full video will be available on my YouTube channel, you know, probably tomorrow or Friday. Yeah, I mean, I have to say, I mean, I didn't follow a lot of the other matches, but I mean, this must have been one of the closest matches, you know, in the entire season, yeah. Not to mention the playoffs.
The four rounds with 2-2, so incredibly close.
Wow. Well, okay, we'll sign off. Guys, we will be back. Maybe not all three of us, depending on who's playing next week, but we will be back with more coverage next Wednesday as the Hackers take on the Windmills in round 2 Pro Chess League playoffs.
Yeah. Did you, okay.